Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Right. So, from now, till about 1:15 p.m., I will be the separator between you and the lunch. So, if you're going to talk about some interesting topics, unlike the conventional agile coaching stuff, I am not going to talk about any of those things. It's not a training as what is that you have to do once you become an agile coach. So these concepts are all about what is that you have to do to become an agile coach. How do you gear up to today's requirement? So there's going to be a variety of topics. There's going to be a lot of discussion. There's going to be some exercises. There's going to be some videos. And some interesting topics we'll talk to understand the science behind some of what we hear, what an agile coach has to do, but how do you equip yourself to answer those questions? For example, I heard one conversation where she said, I'm an agile program project manager. And somebody said, oh, the project manager is still there, only agile as a manager. How do you overcome such syndromes? Right? How do you overcome such syndromes? And somebody asked me, oh, where is Amshi? He asked me today, how do I change the behavior of people? I don't have an answer for it. There are many people who have tried and failed, but that's something that we have to learn. How do we change the behavior of people? So we'll try to understand a little bit about a few concepts of how do we change behavior. So we're all ready?
Yes.
Let me give a quick introduction about myself. How many of you know me?
Yeah.
Very best people. So for those of you who know me, you know my name. For those of you who don't know me, the main same. So my name is Anand. And I've been in this industry for the last 19, 20 years. So what happened to me in the year 2009 was something that changed my life. So I was also like the conventional project manager, beating people to get the job done. And so I was working in HP, and there was this something called headcount metrics that we were doing. So, one of my manager had put 0.2 in one project, 0.16 in one project, 0.4 in one project, and the remaining in one more project. So, I asked him, how do you expect me to do 0.2 here? What do you mean by 0.2? 20% of 8 hours per day is 2 hours, or less than 2 hours. What is that I can do by the time I go sit and try to talk to people? It's 1.5 hours. And what will I do? It is less than 2 hours. He said, that's how it is. This saga of 0.2, 0.16, 0.4 and remaining went for 3 months. So it was a meeting when my manager's manager, all the big guys were sitting, and I made one horrible statement which created a lot of problems for me. So they were all putting this metrics, and then it was only Excel file. I think Excel has killed all of our productivity and our brains. Excel has killed it. So they have added up everybody, and they are now saying that who is more than one, who is less than one, how do we mix and match the numbers? So I told my manager that it's time for us to start reducing, stop thinking about headcount and start thinking more about what is counting inside the head. We are all becoming slaves to those tools, and we're not learning anything. So I said, instead of focusing on headcount, can you focus on to count inside the head? So my countdown started that day. So I had a very bad experience, which started pushing me to look for some other job within the organization. Fortunately or unfortunately, I got a job. I got a project manager job, and it was for product development. A services organization, a product development is a very rare configuration. Very difficult to get this opportunity, and everybody said product development is great. And I did not know anything about Agile when I started this in 2009. Let me be very honest, I did not know anything about it. So 2009 to 2012 was where I got beaten royally. There was absolutely no respect for us. But we learned a lot of lessons. Lesson number one I learned is that there is no requirement document in this world anymore. Lesson number one I learned. And slowly my interest towards Agile started growing. And the best part was we did all what we are not supposed to do. After 3 years, I read the Scrum guide, and I realized, and I started marking, Scrum says do this, but we are doing opposite of this. Some says do this, but we were doing opposite of this. Actually, we were doing exactly opposite of what Scrum was telling. And the result was no, our product failed in the market. Various reasons why the product failed, but we failed in the market. Then I thought maybe it's a good opportunity to help others understand or prevent the mistakes what they have been doing so that we can all grow as a country better, as a community better. And hence, I decided to get into this role. So, what I'm going to do now is, I'm going to talk about, we're going to unravel some of the misconceptions about agile coaching, what is a coach, who is a coach. There's a lot of confusion and everybody wants to become a coach today. If you ask anybody what is your goal, they say I want to become an agile coach, as if it's something like learning driving, car driving. So I said, okay, let's learn something. So the idea here is, what is that you have to do to become a coach? Not what will you do after you become a coach, that is left to you. What you will do is left to you. But what I'm trying to tell is, as of today, what are the most important things you need to understand to become a coach is what I'm going to talk. Right? Ready? Okay. So this is my company. And I also have a partnership with a Netherlands-based company. This is the consulting organization and this is the training organization. I recently wrote my SAFE program consultant trainer exam. I'm supposed to get the result in the next 2 weeks. If I clear that exam, I will probably be the first person in Asia to clear it. There's one more person who's claiming that I've already done it. If that person has done it, I'll be the second person. Okay, so why agile coaching in today's world? Before going to why agile coaching, let's do one small exercise. Right? I want all of you to, maybe that table is a good 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, maybe even numbers. Get into even numbers in particular tables. One of you please come, take this chart. 1 representative from a table, please come, pick up one paper and one of this and go back.
I think some of them can combine
that. Okay, a couple of teams can
combine to form one group. Yeah. Okay. As long as you know.
Nobody
told me.
Anything? Okay. I think it's better we all get up.
Yeah,
it's even
odd numbers.
It's okay, now we don't. Yeah. Whose
phone is this? I just say hello. He came with me.
Okay, now what I want you to do is keep this paper at the center of the table. Okay. It would have been great if we had some tapes to put it. Now we don't have a tape. Anyway, we are all agile. We learn how to change. Then I want each one of you to take one pen. Each one of you take one color pen. Preferably dark color. Okay? Ready?
Yes.
Preferably a dark color pen. Now, I am not going to repeat the instruction for the second time, so you have to listen to the instruction properly. All of you have to use your pen and make one circle. Okay? You can use your pen. You don't have to pass the pen. You can use whichever pen you have. You guys decide which part of circle you will write and you have to form a circle. Clear? Do you want to discuss who will write which part?
No, one part. Circle, how many circles? One.
Circle means one circle. Biggest possible circle. Not a small circle. Preferably the circle should touch the four edges of the tape. Clear?
Yes.
Is the requirements clear?
Yes.
Have you guys done your design how to do it?
Yes.
I'll give you half a minute to discuss. Discuss how do you want to draw a circle. Keep the circle, keep it at the center. Keep the people at the center. Now, all of you have to draw a circle. Everybody should contribute. Everybody should contribute. Now, you decide how you would like to do it. You have to probably draw the biggest circle, like this. Left to you. How you do is left to you. Clear? One big circle. Or let's say like this. The biggest possible circle on this chart you have to draw.
One dot, another dot is what?
Clear?
What about the shape?
Circle. Circle has the shape. You decide what shape you want. Ready? Okay. Everything is done? Okay guys, the design time is over. Now you have to start executing. But, Kahani made twist. Kahani made twist.
Okay.
All of you close your eyes. And now draw a circle. Close your eyes. Yes. You have done a design. Okay. But last minute there was a requirement change. Now draw a circle. Draw a circle. You're not supposed to open your eyes. Don't give up. Lesson number one. Try. Close your eyes. No. Close your eyes. Now draw the circle. No. See, they've already done it. You think so? It's okay. They are not supposed to be inspected. You are still busy. You are still busy. Okay. If you're all done, settle down. Okay. So what was the confusion? I would suggest you guys turn this side. You guys can turn this side. So what was the confusion in this exercise?
Full up.
The only confusion was, how can I close my eyes and draw a circle? Did you draw a circle?
They have not closed eyes.
You asked the question whether we need to make one circle or small circle. Make. That was the confusion. We have decided it will be one circle, so how to make a circle. So before closing the eye instruction came, we put a dot that this will be our dot. And the strategy what we made will hit other person so that he will start the other line. That's how we started the closing eyes.
This team started with that strategy. I saw one more thing, that team, the last team. They said, we keep our left finger and then draw, and I will draw a circle until I hit your finger. Yes, a strategy there. I could not observe how they drew it. But that team was saying, you can never draw a circle.
We are not accepting this kind of project. We will not record any benefit.
Okay. So the challenge here is, these are the kind of work that we are going to do moving forward. We are not, this is not a factory. We are not going to do like a factory, the same mechanical product we done every day. We are not a factory model. That is what I am trying to say. Today's world is no more a machine model. We are not going to solve. We are not trying to solve the same problem every day. What we are trying to solve is complex problems every day. When I say complex problems, these are the challenges what we are going to solve. How do you know I am drawing a circle or not? We don't have time to do we don't have time to plan things. Time is very short. We are not manufacturing the same goods. Now, one point what you said is, what is the benefit? Did anybody ask me why are we doing this? Yeah. I said draw a circle, nobody drew a circle. Did anybody ask me why the hell should I draw a circle? Why can't I draw a square? Nobody asked me.
Explain after this. Why?
This is all about people other friends.
So, is it okay to
interrupt
question in between or yes. Shall I park it?
Okay, at the end of the slide you can park the question, right? So again, in today's world, we are not in a industrial revolution era. We are in a world where we have to use our cognitive skills. So in order to contribute better, what we need to do is engage our people. If we have to engage our people, we have to tell them the intent of why we are doing it. The intent is more important today. If I tell you the reason why we are doing it, probably you guys will have better ideas of drawing a circle than what actually I had. I may be the guy who is funding the project. I may think I am the best possible person to solve it, but actually it is you who can solve problems better. The next one is, we have to do innovation today. Without innovation, we are going to die. What is innovation? Whatever question I ask today, it is from a coach perspective. From an agile coaching perspective, what do you think is innovation?
Doing something
different, which probably can solve some problems, is innovation. Right? Innovation is not iPhone. iPhone is one of the innovation. There are so many small innovations that we have done which makes our life easy. Right? What is meant by complex systems? What do you mean by system? What's meant by system? Can somebody give me an example of system?
Laptop.
Somebody said something? Human body. This is a system, right? What do you mean by complex systems?
Lot of interconnected parts,
lot of dependencies across the interconnected parts of the system. Haven't you heard of people dying now of something called as multi-organ failure?
Yes.
What does that mean? What do you understand from the word multi-organ failure? That means all organs are failing? No. Heart is still functioning. But the heart is not able to connect to the lungs properly. The lungs is not able to connect to something else properly. The connections between these organs are failing. So a system is not it is not sum of individual parts. It's actually a product of the connections between these individual parts. Even though if an individual has an enlarged heart, I think the person can survive for so many years. It's not a problem. But if the connection between heart and some other organ fails, then there is a problem. So if you increase the efficiency of the heart, the system will not solve. Automation. Morning till evening, people are only focusing on automation and expecting magic to happen at the end of the year. Nothing will happen. Only 6 hours will be reduced to 1 hour, that's all. Only 5 hour efficiency you will get. overall, if you see the whole system, how connections between each phase happens, then you'll be able to make a big change. So today, we are not dealing with simple systems, we are dealing with complex systems. And complex systems require creative thinking. And creative thinking requires out-of-the-box thinking. And out-of-the-box thinking, breaking the rules. And you can't break the rules. You'll be fine if you break the rules. Right? If you go back to Mahabharata war, Krishna broke all the rules. He broke all the rules, yet he is prayed as a god. Right? Unless you break rules, you cannot change rules. Unless you change rules, you can't think out of the box. So somewhere, we have to start thinking of, as a coach, you have to start thinking, how do you break your own rules? How do we help people to break rules? That's one of the biggest challenges we have. Finally, we need respect. Right? We need respect. Only when you get respected, you will work. Even for lesser salary, you will work. But we need respect. We'll give you wonderful salary, but you have to work in the security office outside. There is an AC cabin there also. There is a Wi-Fi connectivity. What else you need? You have a laptop, you have connectivity, we get coffee, tea, lunch, everything there. If you sit and work, half the people will reject the offer, right? They feel not respected to sit outside and work. And again, there is nothing like getting involved. Involvement happens only when working in an open space. And finally, time is money. What do you mean by time is money in today's world? Can somebody give me an example of this? Time is money?
Multiply the number of hours.
When you're flying between two places, it's very critical that you reach on time, otherwise you can. It has a cumulative effect on your.
That's one example.
Yeah. Time to market.
Time to market.
Opportunity lost.
Opportunity lost. So what was the advantage we had 3 decades back?
We had the leeway.
We had. Like today, we don't have that extra buffer. You have to do within a given short span of time, and we will see how leaders will do. I'll ask you to answer a couple of questions later in the session. So, this is what is called as Kanawin framework. How many of you have seen this video? About 20% of you. So, let me explain again. The outcome of this workshop is going to be a lot of homework. I'm telling you, what is my objective? My objective is to help you how to prepare to get into this job. So this is homework number one. Go type this on YouTube. You have about a video from a guy called Dave Snowden. Right? I want all of you to watch that video. He gives a beautiful explanation of about how systems can be organized based on their complexity. So he divides the whole world into 4 kinds of systems. One is called simple system. What is simple system? Simple system is where action and response can be repeated and it is predictable 100% of the time. Right? Let's assume that there is a lock to this door and you have your ID. Every time you swipe the ID, the door will open. Unless until somebody blocks your card or unless until the reader is not able to read your card and then interpret based on the logic built, it will open every time. As long as there is power, as long as your fan is working and lighting system is there, wiring system is there, every time you switch on, the light is on. Every time you switch on, the light is off. So the action and the response is 100% repeatable and predictable. That is called a simple system. Right? And in simple system, what we do? We sense, we categorize and respond. We sense, you put the switch, that's the sense. You categorize, the lights will come and you can respond whatever it is. That means it is clearly known how the system will behave. It's very clear, you don't have doubts about it. You can predict what the result is. That is what is called simple system. Next is called as complicated systems. Here, you can't predict 100%. You can predict only for 60 to 70%. That's why it is sense, analyze and respond. You cannot clearly categorize it here. You have to sense, you have to analyze it, you have to work on it. Why did it behave this way? 60% of the time or 70% of the time, it works as expected. 30% you cannot predict. Any example of this kind of system?
So, weather.
Weather prediction system is an example. What are they something?
Even we have worked for a few months or something and we don't know what is the next coming behavior or the pattern of the requirements.
Could be one more way of system. It's slightly different what you're saying.
Yes.
We'll deal with it. But weather prediction system is a good. You have the same set of data. Every time you analyze the same set of data, 60% of the time weather prediction is correct, 40% of the time it is wrong. Nobody knows why. Every time you do this, you have to analyze it. You will get up, you will come up with a different reasoning why it could have failed. Next time you get another one, this is the only job that is permanently okay even if you fail. All other jobs will be thrown out. This is the only job where they will not get checked out, though they give wrong predictions. Right? Here you have best practice. Have you heard of this word best practice? Yeah. Can we have best practices in the organization that can be shared to others? Yeah, you can have, provided all of them are doing the same project. All of them are doing the same project, you can share the best practice. But each group does a different job. You can't share the best practice. Now what you have to do, you have to go for something called, here you have good practice. It's a good practice. Yeah, it's nice, but still I cannot tell it as best because I cannot predict 100% of the time. The world where we are in today is called complex systems, where action and response are not repeatable and not predictable. This is where I tell you don't know what the customer wants and you have to solve a solution for the customer's problem. What is the customer's problem? I don't know. I just have a small glimpse about what the problem could be. This is what is called a complex systems. And how do you do in complex systems? You probe, you sense, and then you respond. And everything is an emergent practice here. There is nothing like best practice or good practice here. It's an emergent practice. What works for this table may not work for that table. Because they are totally in different domains. This is a different complex system, that's a different complex system. It will never work. Right? Can we? How many of you know Scrum here? Great, most of you know. Can we relate this to the Scrum? Probe, sense, respond, emergent. What is probe? Do some understanding, do some research work on it, come up with a plan, and then sense. Every day you develop something, sense is it moving properly or not. Finally, you give a demo to your customer to get a response, is it okay or not. And then you do a retrospective to understand what is that emergent practice that can actually make us better. So the whole Scrum framework is actually for complex systems. If you read Ken Schreiber's book, the first statement he tells is, I introduce you to Scrum. Scrum is used to develop complex adaptive systems. This is what he means by that statement. Nothing is clear, we have to solve the problem. We don't know what the problem is. We don't know what the solution is. That's the kind of world we are living today here. It's not the kind of world where we say, guys, draw a circle. I will give you all the tools to draw the circle. Everything is designed, high level, low level. All level design documents are written. Everything is given and the developer will have to take the document, write the method. No, those days are all gone. That is simple system. Here we are doing complex system, which means to say that it is highly unpredictable environment. And finally, we have something called as chaotic systems. What is chaotic systems? Example, demonetization. A few days after demonetization, we were all chaotic. We did not know what to do. We act, we sense and we respond. Somebody says, that ATM has money. Whole organization runs towards that ATM. That ATM has only 10,000 rupees, only 5 people can get. But there are 100 people are in the queue. Why? We don't know what to do. Whatever idea comes is a novel practice. Maybe it works. We don't know. What do? Here we act, we sense and we respond. Where do you think most of us will be? Most of the time, where do you think which part our project will be? We don't know. That is what is called disorder. I'll give you an example. If the senior most person in the team says, hey, it's not a problem, don't worry, we can solve it. I know how to solve the problem. Everybody will be thinking that we are in a simple zone. Hey, we know, he's already there, he can solve it. If the same person says, I think I know, but still I am not sure, you tend to move towards this one. Can we try something? Can we analyze something? Is what you will tell. Here, if the guy says, I have no clue about what the problem is, I don't know, you are here. Or if the whole organization says, for the first time we are seeing this problem, completely chaotic. Most of the times, you are in the disorder. This is the most dangerous zone to be in because you don't know where you are in. You don't know where you are in. And generally, we think we are in simple system always. But generally, we fall from simple to chaotic. The moment you do a release on the weekend, chaotic system. Nothing will work in production. It becomes chaos. What do we do? Somebody says, can we have a meeting? Can we call everybody in the organization? Says, can we share best practices? What are you supposed to do? Laugh. That's all. You can't do anything else. There is nothing like best practice now. Your domain is different, your domain is different, complex problem solving is happening, and we have no clue about what problems they are. How can we share best practices? There's nothing like best practice in this domain. Everything is emergent. What works for you today may not work 3 months later. That is again emerging. That is what is called emergent practice. Now do you understand why Scrum gives so much importance to retrospective? Okay, so what is meant by Agile coaching? Agile coaching is a dual flavor of coaching and mentoring. In the sports world, there is a difference between mentoring and coaching. Right? What does mentoring do? Mentoring means I have the knowledge, I am sharing the knowledge to make you really perfect guys. That's mentoring. What is coaching? I am not sharing anything. I am unleashing your potential of doing great job is coaching. In an agile world, both are same. You have to do it together. Where to draw a line, I don't know. It is all based on the situation. Sometimes if you do too much mentoring, your teams will say, what kind of a person is he? He never allows us to work. He always gives us more information. Sometimes if you do too much of coaching, they'll tell this guy never involves at all. He doesn't talk at all. So you don't know what to do. So it's a situation-based decision you need to take. When to talk more, when not to talk more. So there's nothing like a formula. So it's a journey, it's not an activity. I have seen a lot of organizations calling me and asking me. One organization in the same building had called me last Wednesday. And that organization said, can you tell me how many months is required for us to, for our team to become a mature agile team?
2 years.
I said, it depends. He said, what do you mean it depends? I said, first it depends on you. It depends on you. If you allow your teams to do work on their own, they will become quick. But if you don't, if you want to keep the control, they will not become. I don't think he liked the answer, but that's the fact. That's the fact. But at the end he said, I'll call you once more, so I think he'll call me. Let's see. And it is in the context of understanding their agile discipline. What do you mean by the word understanding? It's not understand. It's understanding. What is understanding means? It's present continuous tense. That means this process is always ongoing. There is no end to the process is one. What's the difference between knowledge and understanding? What's the difference between it? How many of you, I should not ask this question only to male, no, I should ask this to female also. How many of you know how to play cricket? Do you know how to bat?
Yes.
If I to put you in an international match, will you play? See? You have the knowledge, but you don't have the experience of doing it. You will learn only by doing it. I will show you a video later about the difference between knowledge and understanding. So it's not giving knowledge. Agile coaching is not giving knowledge. This is where most of the coaches fail. They think their job is to teach them how to do Scrum ceremonies. Absolutely wrong. Our guys are all educated. If they read a Scrum Guide 15 page book, actually it is 16 pages. First page is nothing, last page is nothing, only 14 pages. If you read that 14 pages, you will come to know what is it. I don't have to spend, the organization don't have to spend so much dollars on me to teach them what is in the book. Teaching them, the understanding is our job. Converting that into an experience is our job. And that you can get only if you have it. Otherwise, you will not be able to get it. Right? It is an enabler to improve team performance and deliver customer value. What do you mean by customer value? You have heard this in agile world like anything, value. What do you mean by customer value?
What customer needs that, like, at the first time or
business value. That
business value.
What is business value?
You know, a feature which makes a difference to
the return on investment.
It is not return on investment.
Satisfaction.
I like this answer.
Satisfaction.
Satisfaction.
Satisfaction or customer requirements.
See, what he want to see, actually.
What problem was solved?
Something which delights the customer. Which
delight is not. So customer, so there is a difference.
What happens if the customers get delighted?
You get more work, you get more business.
You get more business.
More projects.
You get what do you mean you get more business? Don't think, don't talk about money now.
Money?
No.
You get repeat, repeat.
Something simplified.
Trust.
Trust.
Confidence. Confidence.
Customer value means the ability to change customer's behavior. ATM deliver amazing customer value. They change the behavior of customers doing banking, not this ATM. The ATM machines is of great customer value. They change the behavior. Cell phones change the behavior of people, especially in the photography industry. That's customer value. Customer value means your ability to change the customer's behavior to enhance your business. Flipkart created a huge change in people's behavior of doing online business in India. Flipkart delivered customer value. It is not money, it is not features. It is your ability to change the behavior of people. That is customer value. Right? And finally, it helps in becoming good professional with human values. What's the fundamental difference between the Western style of management to the Indian style of management? Of course, Indian style of management is also changing now. But what is the fundamental difference between the two?
EQ.
EQ.
The Western style of management till the year 1990 did not have a concept of shareholder value. There was nothing like shareholder value. There was no layoffs at all. Only in 1990 afterwards, especially the American and the European thought process became very different, and they started thinking shareholder value. The moment shareholder value came, they started laying off people to meet those numbers. That means we lost the human side of development. But here, we are trying to rebuild it. What is the first Agile manifesto point?
Individuals
are important here. So we are trying to rebuild that human value. Today we are already seeing AI, where humans are no more required. Everything is done by machines. Right? And this is what I was trying to say. It enables individual to undo certain behaviors, embrace true behaviors. Omshi was talking to me today, how to change behavior of people. It is not possible to change behavior of people easily. How do you ensure that people follow lean discipline in India? Do you know 65% of people in India defecate in open fields? Any idea what is the percentage of people in Bangladesh who will pass motion in closed toilets? Any idea? 96% of people. In India, it is 65% passed in the open fields today. Why? Any idea? Research was done to find out. You know what was the idea? Many people believe that if you defecate in the outside field, you will have a longer life. I don't know how.
No practice.
So that's the belief system. That's the belief system. Unless you hit the belief system of people, behavior won't change. Okay. So, again, now you can sit at your own tables. Write a few lines about who an Agile coach is. Based on the discussions we have had now, few bullets at your table, discuss and write a few bullets of who an Agile coach is. Right? Who is an Agile coach? Just have a good 2 minutes discussion, write a few bullets. You can use this book anywhere you have a book. And start using the book.
Listen to them. You can use it. Whatever it is.
Don't write what is not an agenda.
Don't write after all the
response. Who is an agile coach? What behavior or characters you would like to see in a person who is an agile coach?
Check the English out.
So instead of solving the problem, I should take the problem very good results. Yeah, he's a
How do you give instructions to your kid?
They ask questions.
They, first of all, we will not allow them to ask questions. Don't ask questions. Don't ask me anything. Just do as what I say. That's the general parental instructional guide that we give. But what? How do we give them instructions? How do we give instructions to kids?
By showing some example.
We always start with the word don't. Don't run, you will fall down. Don't jump, you will fall down. Don't write in the pen, your handwriting will go for a toss. Don't do this, don't do that, don't touch this, don't. Everything is a word with don't. And of course, we justify why we are saying don't do it. Don't do it because you will fall down. If we can just swap it, run, but be careful, you may fall down. Jump, but be careful, you may hurt your leg. They will jump, but they will be very careful. When you say don't, they will stop doing it. So what happens to the kid? Don't. That's it. It becomes a kind of a machine. The brain will stop working. It becomes a instruction receiving system. Somebody has to say don't do this, then only we will not do. So this is an example that I quote in most of my trainings. There is one guy called small boy called Papu. Papu's parents will always tell don't do this, don't do that, don't jump, don't eat, don't do. Papu is always listening to it, and Papu is very comfortable after about 6-7 years that whatever I have to do, the word sentence will start with don't. Papu goes to school. In school, teacher says don't use your brain, just do as what I say. Papu is very happy. Frequency matching. Then Papu goes to college. Papu is shocked because no professor will teach there. Papu has to do everything on his own. He can't do. So what will Papu do? He will go and ask friends, hey, how to do this? Friends will tell, do like this. Now Papu is comfortable, somebody is there to give me instructions. Then Papu joins an IT company. And there is a project manager to give instructions. Papu is very happy. Suddenly the organization is agile. And the organization sent him to some training, some CSM training, and in that CSM training there are 150 people sitting there. Papu is yawning for the 2 days. After a nice lunch, Papu is also yawning. And after that, management says, you are self-organizing, go do whatever you want. And such kind of Papus want to be the Prime Minister of the country. Just think the cultural change that we have to bring in our teams. We have to unlearn so many things that we have been learning all these days. First, you have to unlearn. Because we were also Papus one. So you have to come out of that learning. How do you do? I don't know. It is left to you. There's no template for how to do everything now. You have to learn your own new ways of unlearning things. Then only you'll be able to do it. So an agile coach is, in one sentence, an agile coach is a person who is ready to unlearn old things and learn new things. That's my definition. And how does it happen? By learning. Now answer this quick question. We have had enough of this, so just give me an answer. What must I focus on? If I am a good agile coach, what should that one thing that I should focus on?
I should not be there with the team for a long time.
This is called destructive innovation. Yes. But it's a good answer. What should that one thing that I should focus on always?
Make yourself redundant.
Empathy.
Learn. Make yourself redundant.
How can you do that? Keep learning. How do you make yourself redundant? Learn it. You should learn it. You should become such a big influencer that people will start imbibing you, copying you. You have to become an influencer. People will start learning. The only way that we have all adapted to this world is by learning new skills. How many of you have done engineering here? How many of you are applying all what you learned in engineering in your today's job? What are we doing now? So we learn new skills. This is also a learning journey. But the difference between the coaching skill and the regular skill is, regular skills you apply one-on-one. Coaching skills, you have to first learn on your own and then apply it on others. You can't directly. It's not like going to a PMP class, understanding project management, coming and implementing those processes. It cannot be straight away. Because this is a battle of minds. You are dealing with human beings, not with machines or MPP files. Machines, MPP files will listen to what you say. Human beings don't listen to what you say. But each one of us have our own priority. So it's a very different skill, and you have to keep on learning always. Right? Now, from now till end, we are going to only focus on what should I learn. and only focus on what should I learn. So let's start with this. What is this? Should I focus on how to build a good team, collaboration? Should I teach them about how to work as great teams? Or should I keep calm, allow them to inspect and adapt? Or should I start fighting battles in the organization, which I know I will never win? If you go and take on management head on, you will never win. Right? That is one more thing we have to learn. Don't take the bull by the horns. This is not Bahubali movie. It will not work. Right? Or should you just focus on learning on your own? What should you do? Should you
share your
knowledge. I am a coach. I am learning. My job is to learn, I am learning. Should you impart learning to others or should you become equipped? That's one thing. Or should I think what to do always? What is the best thing to do? Should I be thinking? Or should I stop worrying about people and start worrying about working with machines? That's the next one, right? AI is the next boom that's coming in. So better stop working with people and start working with machines. Start that. Or should I start focusing on some current challenges what you have, like rain or fire, or should I start focusing on the family also? What should be the focus?
Depends
is the answer. Most of the answers in this session is depends is the answer. Everything has a pros and cons. Everything has pros and cons. If you spend too much time, I like the word work-life balance. Life is in between work and balance. It's stuck in between, sandwiched between the two. But you don't know what life is. Because the biggest problem we have is either we live in the past or we are worried about the future. We never live in the present. That's the biggest change as a coach you have to bring in, which we will talk about something called mindfulness in the upcoming slides. So let us talk about this guy. His name is Salim Durrani. Right? He lives in Kashmir Valley. He never sleeps in the same place two nights. He is always wandering, right? And he has killed a lot of soldiers. See this. He has killed a lot of soldiers. He is Salim Durrani. And there is a huge prize money on his name. Who do you think this guy is? Terrorist?
Yeah.
How many of you would agree to him as a terrorist?
Without knowing the background, how we can say. Can be a soldier also.
For your kind information, he is one of the most respected soldiers of the Indian Army. He has taken one of the roles to find out the. His name is Salim Durrani. He lives in Kashmir Valley. He is always hunting these terrorists. So he will never sleep in the same place two nights. The terrorists have given him prize money to give whereabouts of this guy. It's not the government. The terrorists have put a price tag for him. And he is this guy. His grandfather served the Indian Army. His father served the Indian Army. He is serving the Indian Army. His son is also planning to serve. I think next year he is planning to join the Indian Army. So four generations have been serving the Army here. The moment I showed this picture, 80% of the people will think he is a terrorist. Lesson number one. When you are trying to build your coaching competency, don't think about perceptions. No perceptions. Till you examine and find the reality, don't go by any other words. Don't believe others. You have to experiment and then learn. So lesson number one is get rid of perceptions. Right? So this is his. So don't jump into conclusions. And the other biggest mistake we take is, somebody said, nobody told me he is an ordinary citizen of the country. Either he is a terrorist or he is an army guy. We always take extremes. How many times you have taught in your projects that either the project is going to be successful or the project is going to be disaster. Nobody will come somewhere in between and tell it may be okay also. No. We always think extremes. Either super or bullshit. Either you go celebrate every quarter, team lunch, or for the next one quarter, not going home only. One of the two. We never learn how to come somewhere in between. Our perceptions are so strong about individuals and teams that as an agile coach, you should never jump into conclusions and don't take extreme steps. Always try to start from the center and then see where to go. But human tendency is always go to extremes. That lesson number one, don't go into extremes. Right? What do you understand from this picture? You have to watch carefully. One of the other important is watching.
To face.
Huh? Animals.
Two people.
And shadow.
This is what is that picture of?
So many people.
It's
people. Husband, wife, kid.
It's family.
It's a family. When I do this, it looks like an animal. Lesson number two. When you are trying to make a decision, get deep into it. Don't look at the superficial team behavior and conclude on their capabilities. Or don't look at the child. If you want to really understand the problem, go to the grassroots of the problem and help them solve the problem. Don't look at something and perceive something else and take decisions or make comments. Every comment you make, every comment the coach makes has a huge impact on the team. If a coach makes a negative comment about the cricket team, the next match is going to be not to the fullest potential of the team. It's going to be slightly negative. So you will have to dive deep into the concepts to really understand what this concept is all about. So there are many types of coaches in this world. This is one coach who is always silent, sitting in the gallery and making some notes. Right? This is one coach who comes to the field, helps the team members to learn the art of boxing. Not just sitting and watching and making notes, comes, gets into the field. There is one more coach who is simply shouting at the end of the boundary, yelling at team. And there is one more coach who is giving instructions regularly. Now, I would like to discuss with you what's the best coach behavior for the IT industry.
Depends.
Let's answer the pros and cons of this. What is the pros and cons of this behavior?
Observe.
The behavior is you are observing, you are listening, you are making notes. But what is the outcome of this?
Not connecting with the team.
Not giving the live feedback.
There is nothing like a live feedback. Yeah, at the end of the day or maybe at the break, the coach gives a session feedback. Right? In today's world, do you think that works?
No.
No. Okay. Look at this coaching.
No, but that can work for the one-to-one.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter.
So actually we need a combination of all
the two situations.
Okay.
Very different.
Very different. Great. Let's compare to this situation, this kind of coaching, where the coach gets to the field and helps you step by step. Initial stages it may help. Till this guy becomes proficient in coaching, in boxing, or till guy is able to understand the skill, yeah, it helps. In the IT industry, do you think this is required?
It's not scalable. No.
Required.
It's not scalable. Is it required?
Freshers, yes.
Yeah, maybe freshers. Yeah.
No, I will little partial disagree. This is required. Because I have experienced that agile coaches come with the jargons. But when we go for the product coaching, exactly what is G2M? I go and talk to any agile coach. How you can help me in defining my roadmap of the G2M?
I know only G2H. I don't know G2M. G2H means go to hell.
Yes. so those things are also required. I am not saying that for specific, but that is the also area that we have to look for.
No, okay. But still, don't you think if you are going with this one, you are very limiting to the person, whereas being a coach, you have to mature the whole organization.
No, I'm not saying about this, only specific to this.
Yeah, but this also.
You had some point, right? You had some point.
Yeah, it depends on what you mean by coaching. If you are a technical coach, teaching people how to write unit tests, how to refactor, you need to show them how.
Exactly.
So you just cannot be hands-on.
What about this coach?
Okay, do some refactoring.
This is also a highly paid coaching job. What about this coach? Yelling at teams?
Not required.
Okay. What about this guy? Giving instructions, motivating. Look at the body language of this guy. is so involved. So what kind of behavior is required for the IT industry? There is nothing like one answer for it, right? It depends is the right answer. But again, based on the situation, you will have to deal with this. Right? This is going to be very, very powerful when you have to give strong messages to your team about discipline. If you shout at people, people won't change their behavior. If you want, then giving one word feedback makes a terrific change. As he said, if you are a technical coach, when you are trying to teach Agile to a fresh graduates who have come from college, probably you have to get into this role. You teach them how to write a code. You have to get into the concept of how to write a code also. Maybe how to write a method. How to ensure that you write multiple methods instead of putting all the logic in one method, how do you write multiple methods? This is also important when there is too much of indiscipline in the team. Sometimes you will have to take a stance of being very strict. Right? Have you seen Chakde movie?
Yes.
What happens when those three girls come late? You're out. That's the kind of a behavior. We cannot do in an IT industry, but somewhere you have to give this strong message of not happy with certain behavior. And finally, this is also equally important. You have to get involved. In the current assignment that I'm currently working on, we are trying to write a module. We are trying to write a module where there is a one-click automated installable. The module is being written with so much of inbuilt logic that it can handle most of the failure conditions. And they wanted somebody, they called them as dummy testing. I said, I will become the dummy. Anyway, in front of you, you think I am dummy. Give me the test, I will test it. I found at least 25 mistakes in that. 25 silly mistakes. I put a comma instead of a full stop. I said, why are you not handling it? The customer can do, layman can do anything. Why are you not thinking like a layman? I am doing like a layman. And when I am typing the one-line command instruction, I made a mistake in the command line entry. I gave a wrong shell script name. And it just threw me an error, technical error. How should I understand a technical error? Suddenly it became very much so. I also have to sometimes show them the right way of doing things. Sometimes, right? Okay. So, this we played this anyway, starting itself. Okay. Now this is an important slide for all of you to understand. We'll take a, what time you want, Naveen? What time is the break?
We can do the break.
Can we do a break now?
Yeah, okay. He is ready.
Okay, we'll come back in 15 minutes.
Yes.
There are a lot of things to cover.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So what has happened is the temperature has gone up. Globally, the temperature has gone up. So if you were in Bangalore 25 years back, the maximum temperature was 18 degrees. Today it is 37 degrees. Last summer it was 37 degrees. Now how are we solving this problem?
AC.
What will happen when you switch on an AC machine?
It will exit the hot air.
It will pump the hot air back to the atmosphere. In turn, what you are doing? You are increasing the temperature of the atmosphere.
Right.
So the way we are trying to solve problems is going to create a bigger problem tomorrow. That's the only way IT can survive, right? Create one so that we get more money in maintenance. Unfortunately, the reason why we are doing this is we have lost the art of looking everything as a system. We just see the symptom. The symptom is inside my house, temperature is more. To switch on an AC, I am inside happy. Outside, let it go to hell. I don't care. This is how we are solving problems. By solving problems like this, we will create bigger problems for our children. We are not solving a problem, you have to actually dissolve the problem. You should not solve, you should solve it in such a way that the problem will never come back again. One of the greatest examples of dissolving problem is polio. The way how the Indian government took that, India, doing such things in India is not easy, it's very tough. With this mass population, they were able to eradicate polio. You can still see polio, one or two remote cases, but predominantly we have eradicated the disease. Because they saw everything as a system, not as a symptom. Look at this tension. Initially, the challenge we had was, traffic used to come like this, and there is an intersection here. To prevent this intersection, they did something stupid here. What they have done is, to prevent one bottleneck, they have created four bottlenecks. One, two, here is three bottlenecks. One, two, here is one, and here is one actually. Three and four. What if we solve the problem? And in fact, if you see, how many of you travel in this road, especially at peak traffic? If you see, at peak times, the police will remove this and allow vehicles to go straight. What did we do with that investment? We did not solve the problem.
Is that road is near to that Sashadri Puram?
No. This is near the Kaveri Theater.
Yeah. Beside the petrol pump.
Yes.
So, in spite of spending so much money, we still have a policeman. The idea was to make it a signal-free traffic. We still have police, and they manually monitor the traffic system. Did we solve the problem?
No.
We have invested money. We did not solve the problem. Look at this. This is Hebbal Junction. The idea of building a flyover was to prevent the traffic. Now we are having serious traffic jam after building the flyover.
Yes.
We had a free flow of traffic. There was one railway track. The train used to, whenever the train used to come, they used to block it. The block was only for 15-20 minutes for every 2 or 3 hours. Then the frequency of trains increased. So the frequency of traffic blocks became more. And then they said that an average guy is taking about, it kind of to pass from one point to one point after the junction, they said it is taking 30 minutes, so we will reduce the time. Today it is taking 40 minutes. Did we solve the problem? No. Why are we doing these kind of challenges? What is that you have to teach as a team to your teams and organizations when you go? First, you have to learn what is meant by systems thinking. You have to learn the art of solving systems. Right? Now, why is that we don't think as system when we try to solve problems? Because we have learned the art of divide and conquer. Every problem in the world, break it up into small pieces, solve each problem, assume it will all talk to each other, integrate at the end. Then only you get to know the problems. Integration phase is the most toughest time. Why are we doing this? Is because we never start thinking holistically. There was a lady, there was this University of Pennsylvania where Dr. Russell Lockoff, there's a guy called Russell Lockoff who was the dean of the university. Next to this university was a locality of all senior citizens. They were all widows of, or their husbands had died in the war, or their husbands had died in the police service. And there were some senior citizens who were also staying there. There was one guy in the morning and all the HODs were sitting like this and discussing. A guy comes and says that 88-year-old lady died of a heart attack today. So they asked what happened. This lady had gone to the hospital to the doctor. The doctor saw the lady. He said, "Everything, you are fine." She was a heart patient. She was climbing the third floor when accidentally she had a massive attack and she collapsed, fell and she collapsed. Right? So the Department of Community Medicine says it is a medical problem. Why? Because we don't have doctors in our locality. If we had a doctor in that locality, this lady would have not gone. The Department of Economics says it's an economics problem. We have enough doctors, but doctors want to work in private hospitals because they can make more money. It's an economic problem. The civil engineering HOD said it is a civil engineering problem. Why? If the lady had not climbed three floors, probably she would have survived. And finally, the Department of Social Work, the HOD started laughing. She said, "None of you know anything about the lady, you are jumping into solutions. Look at each solution root cause analysis they have done. They have done based on their department." But nobody knows the reality. The reality is that this lady got married at the age of 20. She had her first baby at the age of 21. Her husband abandoned her at the age of 21. So she worked in small restaurants as a maid and helped the baby to grow. There was a son who went to the school, and then the son went to the college. He got first grade and now he is a very famous lawyer in the city. And there is one posh area where all the rich people are staying. He has a huge mansion there. The problem is not with the department, not with the economics or doctors. It is the problem with the people behavior, where people don't take care of their parents. Had she lived with his son, she would have lived. This is the statement given. Which is correct? We always don't see it as a system. We break it up into based on our departments and try to solve our departmental problem. We never see holistically what the problem is. So unless until you inculcate the culture of seeing things holistically, you will not solve any problem. What you will do, you will end up doing this only. As an example, in engineering, in the great universities of US, in 1900, these were the only subjects. physics, chemistry, biology, psychology, and sociology. These were the only subjects that were there. In 2000, the same university has 450 disciplines. What have we done? We have broken up physics into that kind of physics, molecular physics, that physics, this physics. In fact, when Newton found out the gravitation law, there was no physics. It was called natural science. And we divided it into natural science, into physics, chemistry, biology, zoology, botany, all kind of junk we have created and split up so that even if you go to the hospital today, there are so many specialists. The cardiology doesn't care for what the kidney happens. He says, it's not my department. He says, it's a patient. I don't care. For me, heart is only important. What should the system do? The system will go into a problem. So you have to learn how to look everything, every problem from a system perspective, not from a symptom perspective. It is not easy. It is easy for me to tell in front of everybody. When you go to the field, you forget this. But you will have to realize. That's when you can make a difference. Right? So Peter Senge in his book Fifth Discipline talks about seven learning disabilities. Your job is to first overcome them and then teach your organizations. Let us see what they are. First one is this, I am my position. Lack of system thinking, I have boundaries only this. I am a tester. Give me requirement, I will test. I don't care what others are doing. I don't care for the design. Estimation, why should I estimate? Estimation is not my job. Silo mentality. Yeah, unless you come out of this, it will not happen. What happened with Japan? What happened with Japanese and American auto industry? The
quality.
The Japanese came in, they started eating American market. And what did our Americans do? They were silent, they did not do anything. What happened at the end of the day? They started cribbing that our own people are not honest enough to take our products. They will buy some other cheaper products. Same thing happening to us. China is pumping all the goods. Our own people. So this is actually wrong. It is not the problem with people. It's not the problem with China. It's the problem with the way how we are thinking. We are not worried about quality. We are worried only about the cost. So what happens? We suffer. And we always have a reason. Someone else is there who screwed it up, not me. So I am always worried about my position. What is the second disability? The enemy is out there somewhere. Instead of solving problems, we start looking at who is the tool to blame. Unless, until, as a coach, if you do not, if you start doing this, you're a serious problem. You can't do this, right? The manufacturing talks about engineering, engineering talks about marketing, marketing talks about sales. We always pass the blame across multiple system, multiple subsystems in this large system. We don't take accountability of our problems. We will not be able to learn. When you go, first you should display this. You should enable your teams to display this. What's the third one? The third one is the illusion of taking charge. The moment you are an agile coach, you are hired as an organization as an agile coach, you think you can solve the whole problem. You will not even understand what the problem is, but you jump into solution. One day, I have seen coaches giving directions. First day only. No, these meetings are all incorrect. Have you ever even thought about what pain they have undergone? Have you ever even thought about what domain they are working? What complexity they are working? No. You jump and give instructions to them. You see, this is the idea of taking charge. By taking this charge, I can solve all the problems in the world. Absolutely wrong. Last one is fixation of events. None of us in this world have an idea of seeing series of pictures. Remember in our cell phones, we have this bus shot. If you take tuk, 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 it takes series of shots. You have to see problems like that. What we do? We only see one snapshot of the problem. We never see the bigger problems. Think about Belandur Lake challenge that we have. Every 15 days, there is one photograph of Belandur Lake. We all see the problem. There is some froth coming out. That's it. Nobody has investigated so far and given a report saying, why is this froth coming? Nobody has done it. Probably they know, but they are not coming out of it. Unless you fix the root cause, you should not get fixed to an event. We are only worried about some layoff happened in that department, some sales went down, some other challenges. She got 17% hike. Huh? I got only 14%. Forget about 17%, 14%. You got 14%, right? How do you ensure that you get 28% next time? That we are not worried. We are only worried if we fix to frames and solve problems. You will not solve problem because series of these frames actually give you the understanding of the problem. Next, the parable of a boiled frog. You have heard about this story, right?
Yes.
A frog is in the pan and the chef will close the cover on it and switch on the gas. So what happens? Frog is swimming, beautiful. Then the water becomes warm. Wow, warm water. Sauna effect. Right? And this is enjoying. Suddenly the water becomes too much hot. Right. Hey, what's happening? What is happening? By the time the frog can realize what is happening, the frog is already dead. This is exactly what happens if you do not start looking at problems and trying to see how to address them. This is what I call as going to comfortable zone. This is exactly what happened to the American market. The American market. They will not look at problems. We will only look at metrics. What is the velocity? How many story points did you deliver?
How much you will increase the velocity?
How much velocity will you increase? You give them something, gain about velocity. Let's not even talk about that. Tell me how much you can increase your velocity. That is the language. We are fixed because that gives us a comfort zone because that is how we were measuring something before. Now we are also measuring the same thing, something like that only. It gives me a comfort feeling. Measuring it in a different way, nobody wants to. And the next one is the delusion of learning with experience. We have to do for the first time the right thing. We don't have opportunity to fail. How many times did that individual learn cycling without falling? How many times that individual jumped into the water while swimming without drinking the water? How many times did you eat for the first time without messing up your mouth? We learn with making mistakes. If you do not allow your organizations to make mistakes, how will you learn? You should also make mistakes in coaching. Then only you will learn. You are not a perfect human being. You also make mistakes, but you have to learn from that mistake. The biggest challenge what we have today is a CEO comes for 5 years, takes all strategic decisions, the impact of that comes after 10 years. And the CEO has actually quit. But when we were eating, what happened? The moment you ate, you did not put properly, your mom or your dad said, that is not the way to eat. There was a quick feedback that you got. That's how you learned. Just imagine if you had given the cycle to your kids and said, okay, go learn without falling. Can the kid learn? No. Even we are in complex systems. We have to probe. What do you mean by probe? Do experiments. And experiments do fail. If failure is considered as something that is not acceptable, how can we develop systems now? It is not possible. So finally, the myth of the management team. The management team can solve all the problems in the world. It's a myth. You can't solve all problems in the world. This is what Peter Senge in his book called The Fifth Discipline explains about the five, about these important things that we have made mistakes here. And one of the biggest mistakes is our ability to ask questions. How many of you in your organization have a culture where somebody asks a challenging question, they get rewarded? One in the room. Which organization is it?
It's a startup.
It has to be a startup. Has there been once where you have asked, where you have told your children, this was a fantastic question, I learned something from you today? No. Ego will come in between there. No organization likes their employees asking them challenging questions. You will learn only when you ask questions. As a coach, they will tell you should ask powerful questions. When you ask powerful questions, you get powerful answers.
No powerful answers, powerful responses.
Rather powerful reactions. You don't get answers for it. So, today somebody was talking, this I stole from the safe slide, so don't make it public. Somebody was asking me today, how do I coach my teams on sprint length? What should be the sprint length? First of all, do you understand why the sprint length should be 1 week, 2 weeks, 3 weeks or 4 weeks? No, we don't understand. But we talk about sprint length. And somebody I ask in an interview. The management team asks you to give them an answer about the length of the sprint. Why it should be 2 weeks or 4 weeks? Can you give an answer? And that same standard answer will come. Especially, the best thing what you have to do is, when you're doing interviews now, You have to sit in front of your laptop, you have to prepare the set of questions, you have to type it in Google and hit enter and keep things ready.
Yes.
The moment you ask the answer, go to the Google first link, click and see, same wordings will repeat one to one. Then I ask them, isn't it this from Wiki page? Not Wiki, I learned it. I said, wow, your learning capability is great. With comma, punctuation, whatever is there in Wiki, you know. So this is the art of teaching them. Why should we have a sprint length of 1 week versus 4 weeks? These are the two extremes, right? Why is that one of the organizations say 2 weeks and 3 weeks? In product development, there are two types of costs. One is called holding cost and one is called transaction cost. What is holding cost? Holding cost is the cost that you incur in holding a feature for the duration of the time for which it is not released. So generally it is time here. 1 month, 2 months, 3 months, time is converted into cost. That's your holding cost. What's your transaction cost? Transaction cost is the cost that you actually spend on testing. Regression testing, functional testing, automated testing, all kinds of testing you do. That is called transaction cost. Now what happens in 4 week sprints, what will happen? That is, items per batch is more. So what will happen? Your holding cost is more, correct? Because you need 4 weeks of time to release it to the market. 4 weeks of time. Holding cost is more. What happens to the transaction cost? For all of them, you can do regression only once. So your transaction cost is less. What happens if you do 1 week sprint? Your holding cost is less because end of 1 week you can release it. But your transaction cost is more. Why? For every end of every week, you have to do all kind of tests.
But Anand, don't you think due to this automation and all, we are reducing the transaction cost?
1 minute. We'll come back to that.
Okay.
So what happened? The optimum is somewhere when the two lines cut.
Yes.
That's exactly around 2 weeks, two to three days. That's where you hit when you do this calculation for 4 weeks. That is why 2 week sprints is better. If you go and give this explanation to your teams, I am sure they will get convinced. But what will you tell? Sprint length depends upon where your product owner is, the duration of feedback, something you give some abstract, what is written in Mike Kahn's book. You just give the same 4 sentences. And these guys will understand, what is he trying to tell us? Is he something new he is going to tell us? You don't, unless they are convinced that you have a meaningful answer, you will not get. So let's understand what is meant by transaction cost. This is the effect of automation. Your transaction cost will reduce it. What happens if the transaction cost reduces? This graph will come like this, come down. So what will happen? Then you'll be able to reduce your length, sprint length. So unless you do automation, you cannot reduce your sprint length. This is the message you have to give to them. Only when you give convincing answers like this, they will be able to understand and they will start believing in you. First of all, you have to learn all these things before doing it. You have to get convinced that you can convince others. Then only you will be able to move. So what is the problem solving paradigm today? You will not get requirements. There is no requirements. You start with signals. Nobody will give you written requirements now. It's all some ideas, signals that will come. You don't get features. There is no estimates. You focus on problems. You plan with hypothesis. You cannot run estimates. You cannot estimate a work which you have never done in your life. Let's be honest about it. So you make a guesstimate. It's a guesswork what you're trying to do. Then come up with a problem statement. Don't try to solve a backlog of stories. You do multiple experiments. Don't guess a solution. Use data to decide. This is the paradigm change that we are seeing in the industry today. But we are trying to do the same old way, which will not change. This is what you have to coach the leadership teams. This is what you have to say. Start with signals, come up with problem statement, hypothesis, experiment, analysis, and conclusion. This is how you have to move. So, how many of you have read the book, The Lean Startup? Go home, read the book. It is only 230 rupees. Don't go to Pizza Hut one weekend with your family. You can buy 5 books. Right? You can buy 5 books. Read this book. If you don't have time to read, there are a lot of videos in YouTube. Watch this book. And these are the 5 fundamental principles of startup. Entrepreneurs are everywhere. All of us sitting in the room are entrepreneurs. You have an idea, you can come up. If you take a little bit of risk in your life, you will be able to do some things on your own. 2 years back, I never thought I will open a company on my own. Never thought about it. But today I have done it. I have taken a big risk in my life. But I'm doing it because there is something, I see a big future, I see a bright future by taking this risk. I'm doing it. Entrepreneurship is management. Startups will not run the way they want. It is not that every employee can do whatever they want. There is a principled way of running the startup also. So there is management. Entrepreneurship means management as well. Third important is validated learning. This is where most of the startups fail. What startups will do? They come with a solution and sell the solution. No, that is not what startups should do. Startups should conceive, see a problem, come up with solutions and validate if the solutions are correct. That's called validated learning. And how do you do it? There is something called build, measure, learn, loop. And finally, there is something called innovation accounting. Innovation accounting is a different way of managing your accounting of your projects, where you spend enough money on innovations. Now, what do you mean by build, measure, learn, loop? This is what you meant by, this is what is the lean startup culture. You build, you have a baseline, you measure it with metrics, you analyze, you again learn, there is a purpose, there is an hypothesis you build. It's a continuous loop. The way how you develop your solution is not one solution. You don't know what the solution is because you are really not able to understand the problem. You may have a problem statement, but how do you validate it? You can validate it only by doing small experiments in form of solutions and then validate it. And the most important thing is this. You have an idea. What is hypothesis? Experiment. It's an experiment. You have an experimental design. For that experiment, you create a design. And then you do the actual experimentation. What do you mean by actual experimentation? You push the code to production. That's the actual experimentation. And finally, you pivot or persevere. What do you mean by this? Based on the outcome of the experiment, either you pivot, change the direction of your solution, or you persevere in the same direction, or you preserve it, or you pivot it. And finally, you again do multiple experiments again. So what happened with Lean Startup is, the guy called Eric Ruse. What did Eric do? He created a company called IMVU. This company was supposed to host all the social media sites and create something called avatars so that you can share it to your friends. So they launched this, they spent about 6-7 months, they pumped in a lot of money, they thought it's a great idea and they started the company. What happened after that? Nobody used it. First day, number of hits was super high. After that, nobody downloaded it. Then he came up to the board and asked the question, why the hell did it take 6 months to actually understand this concept? Can we do something real quick? And that's how he learned the concept of build, measure, learn, and then he proposed a lean startup model. I strongly recommend all of you to read this, because when you go as coaches, this will become very handy. Because this is the culture we have to inculcate in the whole system. Build, measure, learn loops. And there are two important things. One is called as vanity metrics. What is meant by GOK metrics? God only knows metrics. I don't know why it is happening. God only knows. I did something, it is working. It is called GOK metrics. God only knows why it is working. Now what you have to do is you have to understand the two types of metrics. One is called as vanity metrics. The other one is called as actionable metrics. What do you mean by vanity metrics? These are all the vanity metrics. Number of hits, number of page views, number of visits, number of unique visitors, number of followers, friends, likes, time on number of pages, emails collected, number of downloads. All these are useless metrics. Now what is the real metric? What is the real metric? I will prove one more vanity metric today. How many of them are as flipped?
160.
How many of them are turned up?
60.
My God.
160 is a vanity metric. It will not tell you anything. You should not plan for those numbers. But eventually what we will do, we will go by those metrics.
Correct. Yes.
Right. What is the actual metric? I have an idea. I want to start an organization. How many will you join? How many of us will you join me here? How many of you will give me check here? Right away, how many of you will swipe your credit card for my company, for my idea? If nobody swipes a credit card, don't start the company only. Pivot the idea. If 10 people come and say, yes Anand, we are with you, continue with that idea. The real litmus test is when people spend money and come. Yes. That is the litmus test for most of the meetups. If you see, this is the problem. When I launched my first meetup, there were 80 people who registered, 30 people turned up. That day I decided, I am going to charge for my meetup, it's not going to be free. People are interested, come. Even 10 people come, I will do it with the same standard. 100 people come, we will do with the same standard, but it is not free. Now you see, the real metric is coming out. Last time I had 25 people who paid money and came. And they said, this was one of the best meetups I have seen. It is better than conferences that we go. One hundredth of the cost, but the value what we got is much better. That is what is actionable metrics. Not vanity metrics, right? In US who wanted to come up with a model of connecting farmers to connecting people like us who don't have time for anything in the world. We don't have time for anything. These kind of two categories they wanted to connect. So I signed a contract with a farmer for 1 year and the farmer will deliver it organic goods for me. So I am healthy also. So they said the demographic they created the website was for a typical working woman. They launched the idea and within 3 days they realized that women is not buying, it is men who is going and buying it. So we have to change the whole demographic of the software only. So they made it men. Had they launched the entire solution with women as the most important persona for their product, it would have been a major disaster. What they did is they did a small experiment, they pushed it to production and to see what happened. Half the women said, sorry, we don't go to market, it is my husband who goes to market and buy. I just give the list to my husband. Then immediately they changed it. That is what is important in today's world. How quickly you can change decisions to save money. That is what is this. So, declare assumptions, create MVP. What is MVP? Minimum viable product. And then run an experiment. And then feedback and research. This is what is called as lean UX loop. So you will have to advocate this to your teams if they are doing UX. Why is UX so important? Because the form factor of the devices has dramatically reduced. We are no more seeing in large screens, small screens. If I am not able to use it properly, I will never use the software again. I will never download that app again. Once you get 2 rating in your Google store, that's it, nobody will download it again. So UX is extremely important today. Right? What is common between these four? Who is this, by the way?
Hilaraja.
What is common between these four? Musical.
Well-known brands.
Okay. What brand is this?
Oh, okay.
Green Rose.
Unique. Known stuff.
What is very unique about Ilaiyaraaja's music?
We won't live any of, without any of this in day-to-day life.
No.
How many of you listen to Ilaiyaraaja's music every day? What is, so all these four have their own unique things.
Unique.
Yeah. What is very unique about Ilaiyaraaja?
Live.
Live instrument he uses
most of the time.
He uses human voice as one of the most important instrument in his songs. Go and watch, go and see any song. There is no song like a straight line. It's always curvy. And that curve comes from the human voice. That's his unique speciality. Whichever song he writes, there is Raja in that song. There is a word Raja in the song. That is his uniqueness. I have never seen this unique color rose. Somebody had taken a picture of this green rose. Very unique. What is very unique about Google? Google is setting trends in the market. Whatever they do become trend. They were the first site which did not have only one button and one text box as their own website. First site. And many now screens, search engines are coming with the same model. And what is unique about Xerox? Photocopy machine is invented by Xerox. But the word photocopy itself has been replaced by Xerox now. In this world, if you have to survive, you have to do unique things. How will you coach your teams or your organizations to start doing unique things? How will you coach? One of the global wicked problem is infant mortality in India. Right? If you see this picture, the more red it goes, the more deaths you have. Look at this, India is almost kind of brown somewhere here. 40 to 50, I don't know exact numbers, but the infant mortality rates are pretty much high in India. How do we solve this problem? So three Stanford graduates from Stanford wanted to solve this problem. So they decided we will solve this problem. What is the problem? Infants are dying. So what is the solution? Incubator. Do a low cost incubator and solve the problem. It was more in India and Nepal that they wanted to solve. So they came up with an idea of doing a low cost incubator. They did a design for about 8 months. They came up with a design, they came up with a prototype, and they said we'll have to go and then try it out. One of the guys had an opportunity to go to Nepal. He went to Nepal and he was shocked to see incubators are all empty. All the incubators are empty in the hospitals. He's asking, why are these incubators empty? But your record says mortality rates are high, but why are incubators empty? They said it is empty because people don't come. Why? People stay very far. When a baby is born, why in our old Indian, old traditional way, we keep the baby very warm. And even in peak summer, they tie the sweater, heater, everything to the baby. And we're wondering, why are they doing this? Because the baby doesn't have fat in the body. When there is no fat in the body, the baby's body cannot generate heat. The normal room temperature like this looks like ice cold temperature to the baby. That's why babies have to be kept under warm. So they said that by the time they bring the baby from the home to the hospital, the babies are dying. So problem is not with the incubator problem. So this guy goes back and says, sorry guys, what solution we have done is wrong. We go back to India and do. So one of these guys come to Maharashtra, interior villages of Maharashtra, and comes up with a device. The device says, you switch on the electricity till the temperature shows 40, and once it is 40, switch it off, you can keep the baby wrapped. And one of the mothers says, sorry, we will do only up to 20. Why? Because we have been told in our village that whatever English medicine is given, put only half of that. So I will do only up to 20. The other biggest problem is there is no power. From where will you switch it on? There is no power in the villages. So these guys were wondering what to do. They said, okay, fine, forget about 40 or 20. Green light comes, do it. No power. So finally they were wondering, what the hell we have to do? So they came up with a device called Embrace device. This is the device. So this device is made up of material that can retain heat. So they put hot water in between, plug it in, and that heat is retained, they cover the baby. So this device has saved millions of lives in India. This is called Embrace device. how do, again, surviving rural Indian women from breast cancer. If you see, this is the statistics of breast cancer rates in India. If you see here, from 30 to 50, actually it's going up. It's all going up. Red is presently, it's going up. It's a dangerous sign for the country if the cancer rates are going so high. So, how do we solve this problem? You cannot solve this problem in a conventional way. This is a complex problem. How do we solve these kind of problems? These are the kind of problems that, if not today, we have to get involved with our teams. We are going to solve these kind of problems. These are not complex problems. Not writing web page, not writing HTML code, Angular, JS, all that is secondary. But trying to solve these kind of problems is very important for us. How do we solve this? So they did a lot of research. What was the data? Data was this. Breast cancer rates have gone up. Lot of women have started being diagnosed of fibrocystic breast diseases. Because of which, what is happening? They are dying during the childbirth. The baby and the mother both are dying. They did a lot of research. They found something very strange. These cases are very less in coastal region, but as you come to the interior, the rates go very high. So they started seeing what was the problem. The focus shifted from the disease to why this disease is less here. Focus shifted. They found that iodine is the reason. In coastal side, whatever you eat, it contains more iodine. So they don't have the problem. But as you come towards the non-coastal side, the center of India, iodine reduces. How much of iodine is required every day? We require only 150 to 220 micrograms of iodine every day. So the government said, hey, simple problem, man. Why you are worrying? Supply medicine, supply iodine supplements to all women rural. Our rural women said, we will not take English tablets. Sorry, we will not take it. So how do you solve this problem? So they started thinking the whole problem in a different way. They asked a question. Every Indian woman will wear a bindi. They said, why don't we put iodine to the bindi itself? So they put the iodine to the bindi, it became, it's called magic daughter. So the bindi what they put here, they gave free bindis to everybody. Every Indian woman took it. Oh, bindi, you take it. It's not English medicine anyway. You take it. The bindi had iodine, and then they put the bindi, it takes about 6 hours for them that iodine to go to the body. Eventually, it kind of stabilized over a period of time. So this is not a conventional problem solving method. You cannot solve problems like this. If not today, I am telling you, we will hit these kind of problems. We should be ready to understand and how to think out of the box. Right? This is again, I stole from Tathagat Varma's slide. Anybody from Kerala here? Can you read this? What is this?
Hare Krishnans.
There's a movie called Hare Krishnan. It created havoc when it was released in Kerala. Wonderful movie, wonderful story, but it created havoc. Why? Because one of them had to die. So they killed Mammootty. The whole of North Kerala was on fire. How can Mammootty die? They said, okay, we will kill Mohanlal. The whole of South Kerala was on fire. How can Mohanlal die? What do you think they did? They released two versions. In North Kerala, Mohanlal dies. In South Kerala, Mammootty dies. This is a fact, not a joke. They released two versions of the movie. Right? Find the odd man out in this picture. Find the odd man out. One odd man out, I'll only tell you. All are horizontal, this one is vertical. I had to put this because there was no place. But that is not the answer. Find the odd man out in this picture.
Yamaha
is only one. All others are?
Mergers.
Yamaha is alone. But Yamaha, when it got introduced to India, it was not alone. It was a merger with a company called Escorts. Why did Yamaha and Escorts not put their name together?
Yamaha is more popular.
Because of this.
Yamaha.
You had four choices, right? Yamaha-esque. Or Yamaha-cords. Doesn't sound good, yeah. Something is wrong. So they said, okay, do we have any other brand which we can actually try? Rajdut was their next brand. This is what would have got with those names. They said, blindly put Yamaha, you will sell the product in the market. What was the reason? Would you ever, but anyone in this room would buy if I say, we are getting, you get Yamaraj at 50% discount this year. If you can't buy Yamaraj, at least buy Yamdut. Not buy. Product is great, great market, great technology, product is great, but what is missing there? Human desirability is missing. So, when you actually, again, it's about user, it's all about user experience. Does this resonate something to you? It's all about user experience, you stupid.
Yes.
What is it? Something similar somebody had said in US elections. Not Trump. Trump, he will never say anything about stupid. You know what he is. Who was the controversial prime president of US? Mr. Bill Clinton. When Bill Clinton was kind of marketing for his presidential elections, the statement he made was, it's all about economy, you stupid. It became such a big hit in US that he won the elections. It's all about economy, he said. It's all about user experience. This is again a wonderful scanning machine by a guy called Doug. He's from a senior GE designer. It's a beautiful MR machines. But what was the problem? The problem was this. 80% of the kid aged between 3 to 7 required sedation. They were sedated before going to the scanning machine. Tell me, which 3-year-old kid will be happy to look at this machine? And the machine, they will go inside also. They used to scream, and if you scream and move, the pictures won't come, the image won't come properly.
Yes.
So you should not move. So they were giving sedation. This was the user experience. How users were using our machines. How many of you ever even thought about coaching teams or how is users experience of our products? HP did a great thing to understand this. They signed a contract with the customer and said, from the time you buy the product, from the time you take the product to your house, you open it and start assembling and start printing it, we will video record it. They completely video recorded and then they saw where the problem was. At what point the customers used to get stuck and they changed the way how they gave instructions. So what did Doug do? He went back, he changed the whole product, and the goal of the product was every kid should tell dad, can we come here again tomorrow? This is what he did. This is called adventure series. Every kid was thrilled to see this. And they said, yeah, we want to come back again. This is what is called user experience. Now what happened because of this user experience? No sedation, right? No side effect for the children. The throughput increased. I'm slowly introducing technical terms now. The throughput increased. What is the throughput? The number of scans per day increased. What happens when you do more number of scans per day? Hospital can make more money. More patients can be served. Treatments can be given quicker. So one small change triggers so many things. Right? What is this?
Ten.
Come on. Why are you guys not thinking like this? Is this the only way to solve 5 plus 5 equal to 10?
No.
A number of ways, right? 100 by 10, 5 plus 5, 2.5 plus 5 plus 2.5, 9.5 plus 1, 1,000 ways of solving the problem. But what happened? We all said 5 plus 5 is 10. Did anybody ask me whether it was base 10 or base 8 or base 7 or base, what is it? We all go with 1. This is what is called as fixed mindsets. We have something called a mental model. A mental model says this is the only way to solve the problem. This is the only way to measure success. All metrics have to be the same way of waterfall metrics in agile projects. Doesn't it sound familiar? This is mental model. We don't want to change. If you don't want to change, how will you influence others to change? You can't change. Because we always believe that there is only one answer. But you should start teaching your team saying that this problem can be solved with infinite number of ways. Can we explore it? That's the mindset change the team should get. Your team members should ask a question, this is the only way to solve the problem, that means your job is done. Till that point of time, you have to be hitting them at this point. What is the answer for this? Somebody knows the answer, don't tell. Let me give others to try. What is the answer for this?
Six.
Six. Six is correct. Is there any other answer? Don't, if you know the answer, don't tell.
Eight, nine.
Think out of the box.
R.
What is R?
Reverse
gear. This is your car gear system. We were so much involved in 1 into 2, 2 plus 3, that model only we were thinking. We never thought out of the box. Time has come for us to start thinking out of the box. Right? In order to understand out of the box thinking, you have to start observing things. Right? Trying to see the unseen. What is the difference between these two cards?
Four wheels and...
Exactly. Camel carts in Rajasthan have 2 wheels. Camel carts in Haryana has 4 wheels. Why?
Sand.
If the same question your kids would have asked, you would have said, will you please shut up, don't ask silly questions. So these are the kind of questions that will trigger thoughts in our mind. Why? Does anybody know? Can somebody give me an answer for it?
Sandy
road.
In Rajasthan, the soil is not hard. Plus, it is a desert. You can't grow more there. Whatever you grow is not thick bark. So it is light in weight. So 2 wheels is enough. But in Haryana, it's not the case. It's completely green fields.
Yes.
So what you grow is too much. So you need four wheels. These are the kind of thoughts you have to start putting in your team's mind. Some questions you have to ask them like this, out of context, so that they'll start thinking differently out of the box. And you should start observing these things. First of all, before telling them, you should start observe, see the unseen things. Only when you start seeing the unseen things, you'll be able to make bigger changes. Right? So, design is no more about now, it's about design thinking. Remember learning what we spoke? This is thinking now. It's a verb, it's not a noun. So, what is the model of design thinking? This is how it is. You have an empathy. What is empathy?
Put
ourselves from experience the problem.
Yes.
That's called empathy. Empathy, define, ideate, prototype and test. Look at this graph. What does this mean? When you do empathy, it opens up. Lot of things get covered. And then when you kind of get into the definition phase, you again converge. Again, ideation phase, you again open up. When you are defining a problem, don't think of solutions. When you are thinking of solutions, think more of solutions. One problem has multiple solutions. Which is the best solution? We don't know. Right? In this story of ideation phase, focus shifts. The focus shifted from the disease to the behavior of the woman. The focus shifted from an incubator to the mother's behavior of how they treat the child. So in every success story, you see, focus keeps on shifting. Similarly, in your problem solving as coaches, you should learn how to change the focus. Otherwise, you will be fixed in one direction, you will not be able to think anything different. This is another example of design thinking. If you go to rural Brazil, go to rural India, go to rural Philippines, the houses are being built so close to each other that they don't get sunlight even in daytime. This is the way how they got daylight. This is a bottle, this is a cola bottle, and they put water, they put some soda into that. So baking soda, because of refraction of light, you get a light as if there was a 40 watts bulb in the day. Forget about night times, what they do, I don't know. But at least in the day, they are able to solve the problem. If people had not gone to that slum to stay with them to understand the problem, do you think they were able to solve these kind of challenges? These are called as wicked problems, which will have impact on a large number of people. Slowly, our industry will start solving these kind of problems. Google has already started thinking of ways solving these wicked problems. One of the wicked problems that we had was we were not able to find a location easily. Did Google solve it? Google has used these kind of methods to solve those problems. So our solutioning process is no more linear like this. It's completely like this. It's totally non-linear. That is why requirements, design, development, testing, release will not work anymore. That's a linear thinking process. It's totally non-linear way of working you need. Let's come to a most important topic called the goal. How many of you have read this book? If you have not read this book, please read this book. This is a must book. This is published in 1983 and we're still not able to understand the concept for this book. The goal is a very important book. This is a guy written by a guy called Eliyahu Goldratt. He's an Israeli. He was a physicist. He has written about this book is all about a production plant that is about to close and how they implemented certain concepts to improve it. And the book he writes about this. The goal of the company is to make money now, not in the future. If you are opening a factory, you have to make money now, not 10 years down the line. There's no point running a factory for 10 years without making money. Right? And if the two objectives are in conflict, survival supersedes greed. Only people who are on the verge of survival create innovation. Otherwise, people are not worried about it. Right? So what are the three important things that he's going to teach? These are the three important things that he is going to teach about goal. This is extremely important for you because this is what you are day in and day out teaching your agile teams. First one, increase throughput by sales. What do you mean by that? What do you mean by increase throughput by sales? That means whatever you are producing, you should be able to sell it. That is what is called increase throughput by sales. What do you mean by this? Reduce? What do you mean by that? Don't waste money by investing on something which you will not use it. What's the third one? Reduce operational expenses.
So critical chain method, right?
Yes. The most important thing which the Indian IT industry has failed to understand is the point number three. They have invested a lot on automation and now they are crying, our testers are losing their jobs. What were they doing all these days? Why do we need automation? To reduce the operational expense. After if you do automation and keep the same number of testers, not reskilling them to anything, what are you doing? Only billing. They were worried only about billing. They were not worried about this challenge. Now suddenly they woke up, oh, we are all losing our jobs. What was the testers doing? They were in a comfort zone, boy frog. This is the problem what has happened. Now let's try to understand how these three things affect us. What do you mean by increased throughput by sales in an IT world? The moment you take a user story in an iteration, it has to come to the done state as soon as possible. Throughput means the ability to do number of stories within a short duration of time should go up. What do you mean by sales? Which means to say that you should be able to push it to production. There is no point keeping it in a staging environment hatching eggs. Second point is reduce inventory. That's exactly what I'm trying to tell. If you don't push it to production, it is inventory.
Yes.
You're not making money out of it. You're not selling it to your customers. You are not getting feedback. What is the third one? Reduce operational expenses. Now, how do you coach your teams with these three points? Let's quickly discuss. Any thoughts? Increase throughput by sales. I have been telling my teams, the only way to visualize the throughput is to put a scrum board. Put a scrum, physical scrum board to visualize the throughput. Teams are very much upset. We are in technology. You are asking us to do some old method. It's okay. Old methods are fine. As long as they don't hamper our work. How much time does it take to push a post-it from this column to this column? No, we will do it the tool itself directly. Obsession with technology is going to kill us one day. So the ability to visualize the throughput, at least for us, when I say sales, it is done. Let's go to done. Ability to push stories quickly to done is the first point. Second point is what? Reduce inventory. What do you mean by that? Work getting stuck in a particular column. Dev work getting stuck. It is inventory. Why? You have invested money on it, but you are not able to take it further. That is what is inventory. What is the third one? Reduce operational expenses. Reduce the transaction cost,
testing, yeah.
Automation, testing, everything has to be automated. If you can establish these three things, your teams are going to do a tremendous job. As simple as this, there's nothing big science behind this. This is what he explains in that whole book. And this is where we introduce to a concept called as theory of constraints. If you do not understand this, you have not understood anything about coaching now. Ultimately, when you want to increase your throughput, what should happen? There should not be any railway gate. The moment there is a railway gate, the vehicles will stop, right?
Yes.
It has to be a free flow of traffic. In order to get a free flow of traffic, this is what you have to identify. The moment you identify a constraint, what will you do? First thing, what will managers do?
Solve.
Get one more person, put him there. Sorry, that will not solve the problem. That is step number, this step. This is the step. But you will have to do all these things before doing it. Let's watch a simple video. I hope I have copied it. I'm sorry, I will send the link to all of you. It's a very simple animated SWF file. Just have a look at it file. He'll explain all the five things to you. Similarly, in your work, suddenly work gets stuck in a particular column. Don't coach your teams to simply add one more person to solve it. Help them to go through these five steps. You can only help provided you understand it. So this is an important lesson that you have to learn about how to deal with constraints. Only when you can solve constraints, you'll be able to get the flow in your system. So this is one more book that Goldratt has given. Now this book is even more exciting compared to the Goal book. Right? This book is called Beyond the Goal. This is all extracts from Goldratt's speech what he has given in various universities and conferences. He has given is all compiled in this book. He makes a beautiful statement in this book which says, technology can bring benefits if and only if it diminishes a limitation. He makes this statement. Statement looks very simple, but how many times we have failed to use new technologies? We have miserably failed to understand, adapt to new technology. We don't understand what a new technology is. To understand this statement, you have to answer these following four questions. What is the power of the new technology? What's the power of the new technology? Now, you've got a new team as an agile, you are entering into an organization as an agile coach. This is what you have to do. What is the power of the new technology? What limitation does the technology diminish? Third is even more important. What rules enabled us to manage the limitation? What new rules do we need? If you can answer these four questions with clarity, you will be able to convince the management with why should we go to agile transformation. Right? Let me give you an example to help you understand this. How many of you know the software called MRP? Not maximum retail price. In the year 1960s, it's called material resource planning. This was the first trigger to create enterprise resource planning, ERPs. Right? So MRP is nothing but material resource planning. What is to happen typically in factories is they have to plan for materials for the work in their pipeline for the next month. So for the last 10 days of the month, they would get some big brains, sit into a room and do a lot of complex calculations to understand what material has to be procured in order to ensure that we deliver our orders for the next month. The process used to repeat every time. And what happened? Some intelligent geeks like us said, hey, why don't we automate this? Why don't we write a computer program to solve this? So they wrote a program, and that software was called as the MRP program. And DuPont, have you heard of this company called DuPont?
Yes.
What did DuPont do? What do they manufacture?
Chemicals
and paints. DuPont adopted this MRP and they made a lot of money from that. All other organizations said, when DuPont can do, we will also do Agile. Competitors doing, we will also do Agile. And they all did Agile, they did not find any benefit. So what is that DuPont did so special, because of which they actually made a lot of money? What did DuPont do? So what DuPont did was very simple. They said, hey guys, instead of spending any way it's a computer program, a program can run every day. Instead of doing a monthly MRP, he will do a daily MRP. They started running this on a daily basis. On a daily basis, they were able to procure materials. And on a daily basis, they were able to execute their job. And What was the challenge? In case something gets rejected, only a small batch will go. They told the producers also, the suppliers also, that hey, if something rejection happens, only a small batch will come. You don't have to get large, but you have to produce and supply to us on a daily basis. This was a big change. What did our competitors do? Agile? My competitors doing Agile, we also do Agile. What did they do? They took MRP, they did monthly MRP planning. Instead of running every day, they ran only once in a month. What does this understand? You can make profit if you do small batches. Small batches. That means if you do more number of user stories, you'll actually be able to make more benefit. Right? So how did Dell use this concept? So Dell became very intelligent. So Michael Dell thought, why don't I use this? He said, instead of, at that point in time, PCs were kind of standard PCs. You can buy this PC with this configuration. Mr. Dell came up with the idea and said, why don't we do MRP in our system? He said, create a screen where customers can select what kind of components they need. And it was something like a scroll bar. RAM, how much you need. This decrease. So all these components they made customizable. And they got requirement for one computer. They did MRP planning for that day, they got how much requirements of them. They did, this is called just-in-time procurement of materials. It reduced inventory to a great extent, solved the problem, and Dell made huge profits after that. So the idea behind what I am trying to say is, if you want to convince your organizations doing Agile, tell them to focus on principles, not practices. Principles are more important. The daily planning, daily MRP planning is more important than monthly MRP planning. That is why they were able to make money. We are also using MRP, but why are we not making profit? Because you are not able to understand the principle behind the practice. So as coaches, focus on principles, not practices. If you focus only on practice, you will not be able to get any benefit. Now what? Let's answer these questions with respect to this MRP. What is the power of the new technology? We can carry out complex MRP calculations overnight. This is a tough question. What limitation does the technology diminish? It takes an entire week of skilled teams to calculate MRP for the month. This is time consuming, expensive and error prone. What rules enabled us to manage? We only plan monthly, otherwise it's too expensive. We need to buy in big enough batches to last for one full month. This was how they used to manage the limitation. And finally, what new rules? We must replan frequently in order to meet shorter time frames. We need to change relationship with our suppliers and customers. We can outplay our competitors. Doesn't this resonate in the Agile way of working?
Yes.
So if you do not understand the science behind it, you will not be able to make any progress. And what will you coach people on? You will coach people on practices. We don't need practice coaches. People can read Scrum 14-page Scrum guide and understand the practice. You need to coach on the principle behind the practice. Why stand up for 15 minutes? What is the principle behind it? What is the principle behind standing up for 15 minutes? Human beings cannot stand beyond 15 minutes. This is the posture after 15 minutes. We can't stand 15 minutes. So when you make people 15 minutes, you finish up the meeting quickly and go, don't waste time. That's the science behind it. So focus on people, body language, rather than an update initially. Hey, stand properly. What nonsense, why is this guy worried about it? But that is how you have to do. Right? Now what I want you to do as a homework is this. Answer this question, apply the same to Agile transformation and come up with answers. I am sure if you can answer these four questions, you can make a remarkable change in your organization. Right? Let's move forward, lack of time. Intent and muscle memory. When you are coaching, coach with an intent. Don't coach for coaching. What should be the intent? My team should become self-organized. That should be the intent. And what is meant by muscle memory? The brain is also like a muscle. The more exercise you do to the brain, it grows stronger. So what is meant by intent? What was the intent given to the commandos during the Mumbai terrorist attack? What was the one-liner intent that was given? What was the intent given to the surgical attack when our soldiers had gone?
Kill terrorists.
Not kill terrorists. Kill terrorists and not even one Indian soldier should be dead or alive should be there on Pakistan soil. Get them back. Nobody died, that's a different thing. But that was the intent. What was the intent during the Mumbai attacks? No civilian casualty. You know what was the challenges that they faced there? Like our Agile teams? There are so many rooms. Every room can have a terrorist, a tourist, a terrorist and a tourist. And every room they have to put a smoke grenade, bang open the door, and they have only 2 seconds to decide should I fire or should I not fire. If you don't fire in 2 seconds, probably that terrorist will fire.
Yes.
Within 2 seconds you have to do. And one idea that they had is, if a guy is a terrorist, and if the terrorist is trained in a military activity, whenever there is a bomb, any idea how do they, what position they go? They go to the fetal position like this. Because they close their ears. But what happened? Our tourists were sitting in the bathtub like this. In fetal position they are sitting. You had only 1 second to decide to fire or not to fire. Commander's intent is more important. There you don't have a scrum master say, can we have a stand-up meeting to decide to fire? So the intent should be very, very clear. Similarly, when you coach your teams, the intent should be self-organization. Right? And what is meant by muscle memory? Again, in the army, when you go for when you join the army, everybody have to undergo boxing exercise. What is boxing got to do with army? We have come here to lift our guns. But boxing is important. You'll have to box. What will happen? There is a sandbag. You have to hit the sandbag. The bag has to travel certain distance and come back. If it's coming back, you'll need more force. After 10 times, you will not have energy to lift your hand. Then you have to fall down on the ground. On the ground, you are not supposed to fall down. You have to fall on your finger like this. And rotate 10 times. And get up, hit, fall, rotate. Get up, hit, fall, rotate. What happens when you do that? You don't have to go to bar and restaurant to get the kick. You get it automatically. There's free of cost. Right? Nobody knows why are they doing it. People are pissed off. Why are they doing it? But what happens in real army combats, what happens? When the enemy hits you, your head will go reeling. You're about to fall down, but you will not fall down. Your muscle memory will come into picture. Instead of falling down, you keep your finger rotate 5 times and get up 10 times till the enemy dies. That's how you have to coach your teams. Even if Scrum Master is not there, stand-up should happen. Nobody should disturb anybody while giving an update. In a planning meeting, you have to complete it within time box. This is what it should become muscle memory for them. You can only do it if you practice it. If you go to 5 minutes late to the stand-up, then forget about it. There is no muscle, there is no memory. Why is change difficult to manage? First of all, you have to change. What is the problem with the change? Human brain is two parts to the human brain. One part is called emotional brain, one part is called rational brain. Rational brain is the size of this guy. Emotional brain is the size of this elephant. Right? So you go to the medical test, you'll find all your medical report, you'll come go home and tell your wife, you know what? Cholesterol levels have gone up. Doctor said change your lifestyle. And your wife will tell, this is what I've been telling you since last 5 years. You have to go to the doctor to get this advice. Am I not giving you free of cost? Say, okay, you're always correct. And then wife will tell, so what have you decided? From tomorrow morning I'm going for a walk. And she'll tell, okay, I've seen this number of times. Say, oh, then you should not discourage, right? So you tell, it's okay. Okay, do you want me to wake up? No. I have kept the alarm. I'll get up on my own. All I need is one fresh cup of coffee before I go for a walk. Can you prepare? You don't have to get up, but I want coffee. She said, okay, I'll get up. Don't worry. As long as you go for walking, I don't have a problem. I will get up at 4 o'clock if you want. No. 5:30 is enough. So the alarm goes up at 5:15. Your wife will get up and go to the kitchen to prepare coffee. You have to get up. You're feeling sleepy. Elephant will tell. It's okay. You are not going to die if you don't go for a walk one day. This is what will happen when change comes. What happens is, your emotional brain becomes very powerful and your rational thinking will come down. Change is only possible when rational brain sits on emotional brain and motivates your elephant to walk. But for the elephant to walk, you have to clear the path. So when you want to bring a big change, transformation, change management in your organization, you have to motivate your team. You have to be the rider. You have to motivate the team. Ask the leadership to clear the path. Help them to clear the path. That is when the change will happen. Otherwise, even if you stand upside down in front of this building, nothing will change. Nobody will change. They will tell, yes, we will change. Nobody will change. Right? So it's important to motivate the elephant. The emotional brain. Somebody was asking me today, how do I change the behavior of people? Emotions must be created. Then only people will change. Right? So how do you make practice a stick? When you're coaching, how do you make practice a stick?
By building the muscle.
How do you build it? Next important question, nobody asked, how do you build muscle memory? This is how you build a muscle memory. There is a very simple model called a success model if you want to make your practice a stick. Right? It is simplicity. The practice what you have to tell them must be simple. What is the commander's intent? Zero civil and casualty. They did not tell, they did not give a frantic Shankar Mahadevan sentence. Such a long sentence saying that when you go to the enemy land, there is no possibilities, you will have to ensure that you will have to protect your people, you should not kill anybody. No stories, long stories. Zero civilian casualty. That's all is the intent. When you are coaching your teams, the intent should be very, very simple. It should be unexpected. What do you mean by unexpected? Nobody expected Trump to win. It was an unexpected. Nobody expected BJP to sweep UP elections, and nobody expected, and by the way, our politician didn't expect ID raids also. Unexpected. You will remember it for the rest of his life. Unexpected. When you give a solution, the team should be taken by surprise. Is it so simple? It should be the question that they should ask. Next is concreteness. It should be a concrete message. If possible, try this or try that. It won't stick. Try this. It should be concrete. You need to do like this only. It probably will help you. Credibility. You should have that credibility as a coach when you are coaching them. If your teams don't believe in you, nothing will work. Right? Emotions. This is what I was telling you, Omshi. Emotions. It should be emotional. Then people will remember it for a longer duration of time. And finally, it has to be a story. It should be something that they can tell the success as a story. Only when you are able to tell the whole thing as a story, it will get cloned at multiple places. Try to see, when you are coaching a Scrum Masters or Agile coaches, if you can implement this logic. It has worked, it will work. But it is very difficult to do this. You will not be able to fulfill everything. Everything is required for the practice to stick. Try to see if you can achieve it. Right. So there is a very nice story about what a startup can learn from Indian Army. It's called a Z-Kit bag. What is Z? Before going to a war, what all will happen, we will understand. Now, a surgical attack had to happen. So what did the Indian Army do? They first understood what to do well. What is that Zamini Nishan? What is that area that we have to do? What area is it? Next, Khabar. K is Khabar. What is happening in that area? Military camps are there. Terrorist activities are going on. People are coming here. Next is, what is our irada? What is our aim? What should we do? What is the irada? What are we supposed to do? What is our goal, objective of this entire transformation, agile transformation? Is irada. Tarkib. What is the method that we are going to use? What is the method? Tarkib is your approach method, the transformation model that you are going to use. And finally, B is Bandobast. What do we have? Do we have enough support from anybody? Do we have enough food, enough ammunition, enough support? Do we, and the Indian Army generally, when they go and do surgical attacks, they take the help of Air Force. They will tell Air Force, guys, you have to go and create panic on that area by putting some bombs so that you create confusion. Right? That is your Bandobast. It's your alignment. And A is administration. Do we have enough supplies? Do we have enough food? Do we have enough people? Who is where? Which army? Who is commander? Everything. And finally, you have Gadi Milav. What is Gadi Milav?
Time.
Exactly the way how you to sing is 2:57 p.m. Air Force will go bomb blast at 3 o'clock the surgical attack will happen. Haven't you seen in movies, they say, in my watch it is 12:45, what is time in your watch? Can you both set at 12:45?
Yes.
That is called Galini Law. Now let's apply this for Agile transformation. Zamini Nishan, if you don't understand the domain, if you don't understand the problem you are trying to solve, your transformation will not happen. As a coach, first you have to understand Zamini Nishan. Next is Kabar. You have to understand what have they done? Our leadership support is there or not? What have they done so far? Is the client also ready to do Agile transformation? Customers, is the ecosystem ready to transform? Next is Irada. Why are we doing this? Is it because to deliver value or because our competitor is doing Agile? Why are we doing it? Next is Tarkeen. What is the transformation model that I will apply? First I will do an evaluation of their Agile practices and then come up with a model. And finally, administration. Do we have enough money? Do we have enough money for tools? Do you have enough support from your management? And finally, Galini Law. Finally, set the time and just do it. It's a simple model that will take you to the next level easily. So let's spend a few more slides talking about leaders. It was Christmas 1914 on the Western Front. Despite strict orders not to chillax with the enemy, British and German soldiers left their trenches, crossed no man's land, and gathered to bury their dead, exchange gifts, and play games. Meanwhile, it's 2017, the West has been at peace for decades, and wow, we sucked our trust. Surveys show that over the past 40 years, fewer and fewer people say they trust each other. So here's our puzzle. Why even in peacetime do friends become enemies, and why even in wartime do enemies become friends?
Because of wartime, we don't have family support and all this. You are like always in pressure, very heavy pressure and all. So that time even the enemy feels like on a present day.
I don't know the answer.
It's necessity, you know.
Necessity because it's coming to play that. Like even in tension time, we spent sweets with the Pakistani Rangers on the border.
So it's all probably trust. I would think it has something like a trust related. Let's look at this. On day one of the leaders says, the most important asset of my organization are our people. What is a simple thing that the leader can do to break the trust on day two? Lay off people. I have seen this in so many organizations. Coffee talks, they come and tell, our most important assets are our people. Great, everybody will clap. Next day if you see, these kind of news will come out. Where do we build trust?
I think they've changed their philosophy now. They say that it's a moving bus, right? There'll always be people coming in and going out. I heard this long back in not now. I heard it a couple of years ago.
But they don't understand it is also a revolving bus. What has happened today can also happen to you tomorrow. It's also a revolving bus. It's not a moving bus.
That's what they're saying. It's a moving bus. People will walk in. People will be asked. Will be let down at times. There'll be new people coming in. So.
Okay. So what do you want to buy here? We offer three kinds of services: good, cheap, and fast. But you can only pick two. Which one will you pick?
Depends.
No depends answer. You have to tell me two things now.
Good and fast.
Now let's see the impact of all the three. Good and cheap won't be fast. Fast and good won't be cheap. Cheap and fast won't be good. Which one will you select? One corporate came to me and said, can you do leading safe program for us? I said, I will do. No problem, I can do. He said, can you please send me a quote? I sent the quote. Within 2 days, their sales guy responded, their learning and development lady responded, called up and said, Anand, your costs are very expensive. People are ready to do. I had quoted 22,000, including license fees. They said, people are ready to do 15,000. I sent this slide to her. I sent this slide to her. I said, you decide. I am not going to decide anything, you decide. She decided not to come back to me. Right? After 6 months, in one of the conferences on July 20th, I had an opportunity to meet one of the guys from that company. It's a Pune-based company. He spoke to me and he said, hey, would you be doing a leading self program? I said, which company? I said, no. I forwarded his message to him and said, talk to your L&D, find out what they want and then come back to me. I will not do training for people who don't trust me anymore. There are people who are doing leading self program for 10,000 rupees in India. Because they think one of these combination will work for them. End of the day, training is not transfer of information. Training is learning. My job is not to blabber something for 2 days and say, go, your headache, your funeral from tomorrow. No, it is that my responsibility is to pass the knowledge and make you more effective in your work. That's my objective. So I said, I will not reduce my cost. Even if I don't get my training, it is okay. I am happy with my work. But I am not going to stoop and bend so much that I create a bad trend in the market. So I said, I am not going to. So when you're dealing with leaders, these are a few things that you should tell. When a flower doesn't bloom, you fix the environment in which it grows, not the flower. You take a stick and start beating the flower. What will the flower do? The soil has to be fixed. So as a leader, fix the soil. Failure is not falling down, but refusing to get up. In a boxing match, you won't be declared winner if you knock somebody. You'll be declared winner only when the guy doesn't get up. As coaches, you will have enormous problem. People don't respect you in the organization because you are not doing delivery.
Yes.
No delivery, no respect in Indian IT industry. As long as you have a person with power, you don't get respect. But don't take it in a negative way. Get up. Perfection is not attainable, but if we chase perfection, we can get excellence. This is where we have to go. We have to make our people excel. And finally, I like this very much. This is, you have to remember this. If you expect the world to be fair with you because you are fair, you are fooling yourself. That's like expecting a lion not to eat you because you are a vegetarian. People will shout at you left, right and center. You need to have something called EQ. Emotional quotient. And finally, think different. If you don't do this, this is exactly what you have to teach your leaders now. So I will tell you an interesting story about Microsoft and Apple. Simon Sinek is one of the greatest speakers of the world on leadership. Simon Sinek had gone to Microsoft office to talk about the executives, to give a presentation on executives. He had a wonderful speech he gave. And he said 75% of the people, 100% of the time, were putting projections of their sales and graphs, and everything was, Apple is doing this, we will do this. Apple is doing this, we will do this. That's the attitude, that's the kind of the graphs and information he saw. They gave him this Zoom. Have you heard of this Zoom? Zoom is very much like iPod, but it's a Microsoft product.
Zoom, yeah.
Microsoft Zoom.
Correct.
They gave the product to him. He took the product, he said, it is really nice, it's better than iPod. So he, after some time, he went to Apple for a similar presentation. He met one of the senior managers there, they were both sitting in a car, and they were walking, and slowly Simon opens the Zoom and says, hey, this is what Microsoft gave me, wonderful product, you know, it's a great product, in fact, it's better than iPod. You know, can you guess what the guy said?
I know it's better than that, but we won't.
Maybe. Because in the presentation that he went to Apple, nobody was trying to answer questions like, this is what that company is doing, this is what this company is doing. The Apple was, how can we create a world where we can use technology to deliver good food to people? How can we create a world where we can give good drinking water to people? This is the kind of solutions that they were solving. They were going in this direction. Microsoft was going in this direction. As a leader, when you do transformation, go in this direction. Many a times you will feel like going in this direction. Don't go in this direction, you will not do it. When I wrote my SPCT exam, one of them asked me, so what is your next challenge? How are you going to do SPC classes? You've got a lot of competition. I said, sorry, I create my own, I am going to create a trend in India now about what trainings are. I am going to set a standard for trainings. I don't want to compete with others. That is not my goal. My goal is, if people say training has to be done, they say go to Anand's class. That's what I want to hear. I don't want to compare myself with anybody. If your leaders can start talking this language, if you can influence your leaders to talk this language, you will become a great coach. Right? That's what you need to set up as a target. There are a few things that we want to talk. Outcome, output versus outcome. What is meant by output? Output is number of stories delivered, number of lines of code, number of bugs. What is outcome? How did I change the behavior of people? Have you heard of something called disruptive innovation? How did Kodak die? Kodak died because they did not innovate. Right? So iPhone is a disruptive innovation. It created such a big innovation that Nokia went out of scene only. Right? Effectiveness versus efficiency. Don't focus on number of stories done. Focus on, after delivering the stories, what impact we had on the business. That's the effectiveness. This is what you have to coach your leaders on. Shareholder value versus customer value. We'll talk about it in the next slide. And finally, customer focus versus financial metrics. We'll talk about that also. Right. A small examples. In 1925, 3M introduced a concept of 15% rule for its introduced a concept of 15% rules. What they said was, every employee can use 15% of their time in a month to do whatever they want. We don't ask them any questions. They can do whatever they want. And you know, 3M created huge businesses in India, in the globe, because of that 15% time. Somebody was silently building this projector. And it became such a big market that 3M was able to kind of stretch its arms everywhere. Nobody was asking how many features were delivered, how many lines of code, how many stories completed. That language was not there. What impact are you doing to the business, to the world? What impact are you doing? Even today, Google uses it. Even today, Apple uses it. Even today, a company called Atlassian uses this. They give time to people. Nordstrom is one of the companies who are dealing with retail sales. They created a big policy. The policy was, anybody can come and give back any product they purchased any time after any number of years, we will take it back. The whole shareholder said, this is going to kill our sales. But you know what happened? People appreciated Nordstrom's initiative and they started returning all faulty products. Now, Nordstrom did not ask any question, just refunded the money. After some time, people stopped going to Nordstrom because they said that we believe in the quality, we trust you no more. Suddenly, there was an enormous trust between customers and the organization, and Nordstrom sales went like anything. 1 year to Europe. You need to spend there, eat there, sit there, work there, learn the culture, and help us how to grow business there. So another 6 years after that, Samsung literally had new culture of almost all the countries in the world and knew how to do business. Then they expanded. It was a huge success. Right? Apple brings back Steve Jobs. It was a strategic decision to get Jobs. Zappos, free shipping and returns. Zappos is one more company who was doing online shoe stores. In order to change the behavior of the people, Zappos said, you order 10 different shoes and give place an order. We will bring it to your house. You can select which you want and reject which you don't want. Suddenly, trust on Zappos became so high that today they are the number one online shoe selling portal in the US. None of these are related to financial terms. Your metrics and measurements are not at all return on investment. But the impact that these activities created was phenomenal. So it's time for us to tell our management and leaders that metrics is not only about ROI. Metrics is about behavior change. Yeah, how much of money would have spent for free shipping and returns? But what has happened to the trust? What has happened to the trust factor? It's grown multiple times now. So there is an enormous amount of trust that has been built. The business has gone way, way, way up. So what are the lean metrics? Energized, engaged, employees, wow customers, flow of value, global systems thinking. If you can put these four as metrics and come up with some metrics, I'm going to show you can make an impactful organizations. These are the four areas where we have to start creating metrics. Have I created? No, I have not created. Let me be honest. I have not created. But I have started thinking of how to propose these metrics. It's very difficult in organizations to change it. Startups, maybe it's quite easy, but corporates, very difficult to change the focus. Again, commercial organizations across European Union lost 142 billion euro in IT projects in 2004 alone. Why? Because we are trying to build something, we don't know what the customer wants, we don't validate it. So when you go and try to coach the product management teams or the product owners, please teach them this model. This is called impact mapping model. You have to teach them. It talks about what is the goal, who are the actors. What do you mean by actor? Whose behavior should I change in order to reach the goal? And what is the impact we have to create and what are the deliverables? Simple model, go to impact mapping. There is a website, there is a free PDF, download, read it. It's a small PDF, blue color. Read it. It's going to change the way how you think about prioritization process. Somebody is asking prioritization. Use it. It's a wonderful model to use. What is emotional intelligence? I have another 10, 12 slides. What is emotional intelligence? Agile coaching is not following the book. It is breaking the rules. You have to coach in such a way that teams break the rules to create something new. In order to do that, you should have self-awareness. You should know what, where you are. That is exactly in today's world what we call mindfulness, right? Motivation. You'll be thrown like anything in the system. You will have to come up again and again. There is no respect. You'll not be called for team lunch also. Why? You are not anywhere delivering anything, no? But don't worry. Don't feel bad about it. You have to come up like Phoenix. Empathy. Empathize your teams. What is social skills? How do you work with them? How do you deal with them? How do you take those boxing hits and still laugh? And finally, self-regulation. Keep calm. So these are essential traits of a coach. Not Scrum, EXP. That is also important, but these are more important than that. Okay. This is what I would say called mindfulness. This is what is mindfulness. When you are seeing something, focus on what you are seeing, not focus on something else. This is also mindful, but not that full. You have to be this full. It should be mindful, not full of. Mind should not be full of cluttered ideas. Only when you start seeing things, you'll be able to do. You have a boiling water. Some object is there in the boiling water. Can you see the object? Only when the switch off the heat and the water stills, you'll be able to see. Mind is also like that. If it is too much of boiling, you will not be able to solve any problem. Right? This is one important lesson teach your leaders. In a surfing game, you should learn how to surf, not control the wave. You cannot control the wave. Most of the leaders try to control the wave. Wave is not controllable. This is what Alan Ward had said. Instead of learning to surf, conventional organization try to control the waves. This almost never works. So you will have to learn how to surf in the turbulent waters. Right? And there is one more interesting way of something called telemetry learning. What do you mean by telemetry learning? How do you give feedback? How do you give feedback? Not the kind of feedback saying that your communication is not good. Not that kind of feedback. Feedback on the whole work what we are doing. Like this company UPS, what they do is they have GPS antennas here. They connect to GPS satellites, get the information of which road, what vehicle is going. If there is any traffic jam, they call up the driver and inform so that the drivers can take the route without wasting time. This is something what we need to do to give feedback, not feedback saying that 8 stories you committed, only 4 you wrote. That's not feedback anymore. The feedback that you need to give is, we are trying to solve customer's problem. How can we solve it in a different way? That's the kind of feedback, this is the kind of feedback we have to give. Not delivery feedback, it is the value delivery feedback we have to give. Feedback also has to change. Cultural dilemma. When, who is this guy?
KFC
went to China, what did they say? Eat your fingers off. That was the model. Chinese thought, oh my god, we have to eat our fingers, we will not go to KFC at all. Big failure. Right? This is what? There's a big food company that wanted to sell food for children in South Africa. So they put the baby photo on it and sold. Nobody purchased it because in South Africa, whatever you put inside the outside photo of the cover will be inside also. They thought babies are inside the box. So they did not buy it at all. Right? Wigs. I don't want to tell about this, but V is spelled as F in Germany.
Yes.
UPS. It's a China courier company. Wonderful idea, but it was a big flop because they were using brown color vans. In Spain, brown color vans is for dead bodies. Right? And finally, this is for Mexico. This is a company which started selling beer for Mexico, and the hip word was turn it loose. Turn it loose means take it. But in Spanish, when they published this, it was called as get diarrhea. Nobody purchased it. So when you are dealing with cultural teams, be careful about the cultural aspects. Don't try to give the same examples there. It will hit back royally to you. So be cultural specific when you talk to them. Right? So these are the new software development games. I will leave it to you to read. Lack of time, I will leave it to you to read it. A bad system will beat a good person every time. This man has been telling it throughout his life. He died in 1993, nobody has understood it today. He wrote a book in 1950 called Out of Crisis, and he has given 14 principles. Not even one principle has been understood by anybody today. If you have time, read this book, Out of Crisis. It's not easy to read, it is difficult, but if you can read and digest this book, you will become the next Deming of the world. Right? Okay. Now, I don't know, we have time, it's already time up. So what I would like, I wanted to do an exercise. Most of the times when you go as a coach, they will ask you to do assess our agile capabilities. What areas will you focus? I wanted to do this exercise, but lack of time, we'll quickly move forward. These are some areas you can actually focus on. Produce value early, welcome change, iterative delivery, daily business collaboration, trusted motivated team, face-to-face collaboration, working software, sustainable pace, technical excellence, focus on simplicity, self-organizing, reflect on all the Agile 12 principles are here.
Yes.
Simple, you don't have to create something out of the world. Focus on these principles and measure, you'll be successful. Or you could focus on some topics like this. Adaptability, teamwork, learning and innovation, organization culture, technical practice requirements, business value. You could develop something like this also. So it all depends on how do you want to take it. I wanted to do an exercise where you come up with your own checklist, but we don't have time for that today. Right? So this is what I like from Indian Army. This is all, we also have to live like this. We lead by example, we live by chance, we love by choice, and kill by profession. In terms of coaching, we lead by example. In an organization, we have to lead teams and organizations by example. We live by chance. Most of the times people don't like you.
Yes.
You live by chance. Love by choice. You have to love this profession. If you don't love this profession, you will not be able to play a better role. And kill by profession. Kill means give feedback. Without bias, you have to give feedback to people. Then only you will be able to be recognized. Right? So this is my very famous slide, which has got a lot of meaning in it. An ounce of information is worth a pound of data. An ounce of knowledge is worth a pound of information. An ounce of understanding is worth a pound of knowledge. And an ounce of wisdom is worth a pound of understanding. Data, information, knowledge, understanding, and wisdom. Data, information, knowledge, understanding is doing things right, which is efficiency. Whereas wisdom is doing the right things, which is effectiveness. Focus on effectiveness, not efficiency. You will never reach 100% efficiency. No practical system can reach 100% efficiency because there is always inbuilt errors. But If you focus on effectiveness, probably the efficiency will automatically go. Don't focus on data. Data is like metrics. Don't beat the team on metrics. Understand what we can do with that and focus on corrections that you can do. Right? This is the last slide. Do not choose agile coaching for a job change if you are not serious about it. If you are trying to become an agile coach to change your job because market wants an agile coaches, please don't do that. You will fail miserably. Do not just read books and claim to be a great coach. You can become a good coach, but not a great coach. You will have to practically get beaten by circumstances. You should see all dragons in your life. Then only you can become a good coach. Practice empathy and live empathy. Practice empathy. People may give you bullshit feedback. It's okay. But always ask, how can I help this person to improve? Coaching without experience is a suicide path for you and destructive path for the team. I've seen many coaches who come and not only they die, they destroy the team also. They do it. Coaching is a skill. It can be learned over a period of time. It's not Tendulkar's batting ability. No. Even he has practiced a lot. Coaching with finding all the wrong things the team does will make you a great coach. Right? You'll become a great coach. But coaching with all positives will make you a popular coach. You decide whether you want to be great or popular. If you do something wrong, this is what you will end up with. Syntax error, compiler error, system error, this is not career error. You will end up with this. You will realize you are in the wrong boat, but it will be too late. Any questions? I am separating you from the lunch I know. So if you don't have any questions, thank you very much for your time. Spending half of Saturday with me. I truly appreciate your concentration. Right? You can reach me on this number. You can reach me on this mobile. This is my LinkedIn profile. If you need any training, help, be it public trainings or corporate trainings, let me know. I want to change the training paradigm in this country. We have to make our country, the return on investment for each one of us should be really worth what we invest money. We have to create careers for people, not training and leave them on the road. Okay, thank you very much for your time, and let's catch up next time again.
Thank you very much.